story so far. After a lone Ultron bot escaped the Battle of Sokovia and crash-landed on the pony-inhabited planet of Equus, the Avengers and the Elements of Harmony teamed up to defeat the evil AI once and for all, forging friendships with each other along the way. But peace between the heroes would not last long, as a botched mission in Lagos led to the creation of the Sokovia Accords, a law requiring all enhanced beings to register with the government. This ruling split the heroes in half. A brutal civil war was waged, destroying bonds and ruining friendships forever, while also leaving Earth and Equus undefended against a mysterious new foe emerging from the shadows. Chapter 1. It was an unnaturally cold summer night. The wind was rough, hard, pushed against the trees until their tips were pressed to the earth. The moon was no more, either hidden behind the heavy storm clouds, or simply gone. Princess Celestia contemplated these thoughts as she practically pushed herself up the grassy hill. The grass danced beneath her hooves, the wind pushing both it and herself, practically forcing her down the hill. But Celestia was determined. She had faced far greater winds and obstacles in her youth, and even more so in recent years, so a simple storm would not push her down. When she finally reached the top of the hill, however, she soon realized it was no simple storm. Yes, there was lightning, shades of white, purple, and red striking across the heavens. The thunder was there as well, but it seemed different. Unnatural, as Celestia had thought of earlier. Even the storm clouds moved in a way that didn't seem to be nature's graceful hand at work. They swirled over mountains, covered the landscapes afar. They moved like serpents. Even the lightning moved in a way that Celestia couldn't comprehend, following the clouds, striking the mountaintops and the earth below. And the storm filled the land of Equestria, consuming the south and moving north towards Ponyville and Princess Twilight's castle. Celestia could only watch, her eyes growing wider and surprisingly more horrified the longer she stared into those hellish clouds moving swiftly across the sky. Another bolt of red lightning, the low growl of thunder following shortly. Wait. Growl? The earth trembled, prompting Celestia's gaze to the east. The clouds engulfed all the earth in the direction she stared, but in that quick flash of red and purple lightning, she saw something. Something within the storm, behind the mountains. Something that moved and slithered with an unnatural speed, joining the unnatural phenomenon several miles before her. It looked like a serpent, just like the clouds. Another flash of red. No. Not a serpent. A tail. It separated the clouds, breaking the storm with just one slash, and then it retreated within the darkness, slithering into black. Princess Celestia could feel a similar coldness, not one from the elements of nature, but one from within. From the deepest remnants of her heart that she dared not to think back to. The wind pushed against her, silencing her horrified gasps of air. Her glossy eyes tried to follow the tail despite her heart telling her otherwise. She eventually returned straight ahead, right to the heart of it all. The storm glowed bright red, like a newborn star. A second sun. It nearly reached Ponyville when the thunder came back, shaking the foundation of Equestria and making Celestia stumble, nearly fall down. But she stood her ground, forcing herself to stare into the mixture of light and dark, and witness what her heart didn't want to believe. Several bolts of lightning shot across the sky, right over the clouds, right across the massive serpent's head and the six others that trailed behind it. The beast, with eyes a hellish red, stared right at the Princess of the Sun, and it screamed. All seven of them screamed. Celestia woke up in a cold sweat. A natural cold sweat. There was no screaming, certainly not from her, but even from the dream. It tried to come back, but it faded shortly. Celestia simply staring at the wall at the end of the room, until total silence settled in. It eventually did, and she silently thanked it for that. Celestia moved the bedsheets off from her sweating form. She didn't bother with her magic. The dream, miraculously, managed to make her a tad wearier than when she drew in that night. Then again, she was still finding trouble in declaring it a dream. Most of her dreams were pleasant, many of which consisted of her, her friends, her sister, her family long gone, and many things she wished she could do when spending her time not running a country. It was very rare for Celestia to have a nightmare. The last time she did, Lord Tyrek returned from Tartarus. Then again, that wasn't necessarily a nightmare. Such thoughts rebounded throughout her mind as she pushed her balcony doors aside. Instantly, a fresh wave of cool summer air hit her in the face, eliciting a dreamlike sigh from the princess. She closed her eyes and stepped forward, the air cooling her burning sweat drenched on her coat. She almost shivered, and let herself eventually do so. The cool air was welcome despite its temperature. At least it was natural. When she opened her eyes, she gazed onto the railing lining the edge of the balcony. Her sister's full moon shined brightly in the night sky, encasing the balcony, Celestia herself, and all of Canterlot in its ghostly white glow. Celestia sighed again, another of relief to see her sister's moon moving ever so slowly across the starry night. Hardly any clouds as well. It was gorgeous. Princess Celestia laid her bare hoof on the cold railing, gazing to the quiet city below. Very few lanterns remained lit, not a pony in the streets, not a soul awake. It must have been fairly early in the morning, far too early for Celestia to awake and raise the morning sun. Still, a shivering dread caught her by the back of the neck, informing her of what awaited the realm of dreams if she decided to turn in once more. She thought back to the dream, to the nightmare. The storm clouds that consumed nearly half of Equestria were barely there. The lightning had no color. It was surely fading, but still there. Especially the sounds. Especially the screams. Celestia closed her eyes and waited. "Dear sister, what troubles you at this hour?" Right on cue. Slowly opening her eyes, Celestia gazed at the full moon. She heard the flappings of the wings and the gentle sound of hooves upon marble, slowly approaching behind her. Yet Celestia did not turn to meet her sister. She strangely spoke straight forward, straight towards the moon, just like she used to. "I saw something, Luna," Celestia muttered, causing the sound of hooves behind her to halt. The princess continued to gaze at the moon, her eyes falling to the south and beyond. "Something we would rather forget." Princess Luna's face grew pale, even more pale than the moon's glow against her face. She didn't need to delve further into Celestia's voice to know that her nightmare had managed to shake her. Although Luna did not participate, she witnessed it just the same. The fiery storm, the tail that ripped apart the heavens, and the seven deadly heads she prayed she would never see again. "I have noticed," Luna admitted, wings curling tighter to her sides. It wasn't the cold of the night that caused such an action. She approached her sister's right side, staring at her. "What do you suppose it is, dear sister? A dream or a vision?" Celestia didn't even look at her, just at the moon and her kingdom. "I do not know." Luna wished for the former, dreading the latter. Tightening her jaw, she stared at her kingdom, along with her older sibling, sighing through her nostrils. "We must be ready for anything," she commented. "Luna, I fear it is far worse than that." Twisting her head left, Luna stared at Celestia quizzically. She asked, "Why is that, sister?" She didn't turn to meet her gaze. Instead, she continued to stare with those blank eyes toward the world beyond their borders. Though Luna didn't see it, Celestia could see fire in the storms, blood in the thunder and rain. She blinked. "I fear we are already too late." "Do not say such things," Luna intervened with a frown, turning fully to her sister. "It is never..." Sister, don't you see it? Celestia interrupted, silencing Luna for the moment. Her glossy eyes continued stare straight ahead, not turning away. Almost burning. Almost crying. The gates of Tartarus were destroyed, unleashing the beasts and demons who have chosen the path of sin and death upon our world. She wanted to say more, but Luna cut her off. And we have shown them that this world is not theirs for the taking, she said, sighing at her harsh tone. Rest easy, sister. He was defeated and tortured for more than a millennium, longer than I have been imprisoned myself. It would not be possible for him to rise again. I understand that, Celestia said, still staring nowhere. But I can't shake off this feeling of dread. Hopelessness. I froze, Luna. Luna waited. She didn't interrupt. She didn't want to. She needed to hear what her sister would say, perhaps shed more light on the already dark vision. When I stared at that storm, I froze. Celestia's voice began to trail away, becoming frailer with each passing second. Even the cool, weak wind was stronger than her tone. Those eyes that I prayed would never see me again. I do not wish to rest knowing they await me. Several seconds passed, and not another word. Luna sighed, finding no point in digging deeper into what was surely troubling for her sister. The feeling is mutual, she simply admitted. Celestia didn't turn. When Luna laid her hoof on her sister's shoulder, that's when she finally broke away from her trance. If it pleases you, I could guarantee a happier, healthier dream for you tonight, sister. Celestia finally turned away from the world and rested her eyes against her sister's. They both smiled to one another, Celestia dipping her head down to nuzzle against her sister's neck. It was warm, comforting, far more than the coolness of the summer night. Celestia longed for moments such as theirs, to be in each other's presence, knowing they were safe as long as they were together. She really wanted to believe in that. She really did. Thank you, Luna. I always find peace knowing you are once again by my side. Luna chuckled warmly, breaking away the same moment Celestia had. And you will find peace the rest of the day, which should start in a couple more hours. Another chuckle, this time shared by both of them. Luna turned away and spread her wings, ready to take off for the rest of the night. Tomorrow is the day, after all. The day your old student returns from her journey on another world. Another dimension, Celestia corrected, finally turning back toward her room and where Luna stood. The Princess of the Night paused, then chuckled. Our lives have become very strange, Celestia. Another weak fit of laughter between them, and Luna was gone, determined to tend to ponies in their slumber. Celestia's warm smile melted away into nothing, leaving a cold, cold stare in her eyes. She turned away from her room and back towards the world. The night sky shimmered, the moon glowed a bright white, and sounds of the night cried in a conjoined symphony of crickets and whistling wind, all of which Celestia didn't see nor hear. Celestia stared toward the south and saw clear skies for miles and miles. She gripped the railing with both hooves, still hearing the seven screams. Hopefully nothing worse than that. Chapter 2, A Life Away. Canderlot High School, near the portal, 9:58 a.m. Sunset Shimmer hated waking up early during the summer. It had been a long week. A long week. It was a few weeks ago, but that was a long week. Finals rolled in after weeks of stressing and studying, and overall, Sunset felt she did fairly well. If a solid A in every class was fairly well, that is. Sunset couldn't speak for the rest of her friends, but they've been having study groups every night to prepare for the week, so it shouldn't have been too bad for them. She always worried about Pinkie Pie and Rainbow Dash, though. That Friday after class, they looked to be freer than birds, more so than the birds that instantly rested upon Fluttershy's shoulders the second she stepped out of the school. Sunset couldn't help but feel the same way. All that studying seemed to pay off. They all passed with an A. It was a long school year, a lot of crazy adventures and magical chaos, and finals week was a pain. But it was over. School was out, and summer vacation had arrived at long last. Sunset and her closest friends, which consisted of Twilight, Applejack, Rarity, Pinkie, Fluttershy, and Rainbow, all spent that Friday night celebrating with pizza, video games, and fresh soda that could fill Canterlot High's soccer team. Oh, and Spike, Twilight's talking dog. But no one needed to know about that. Later that night, Sunset wrote in her journal to Princess Twilight Sparkle in Equestria. They wrote for hours, even after everyone had turned in for the night, just to make sure everything was settled and confirmed for the next few weeks. That was a few weeks ago. It came so fast. Sunset still couldn't believe she was going to do it. "So, let me get this straight again," Rainbow Dash yawned, cracking her back as she and her friends approached the Canterlot High statue directly in front of the empty schoolyard. The early morning sun burned everyone's tired eyes. Everyone's hairstyles were poorly done, even Rarity's, but they managed for the occasion, dressed in the same outfits and dresses as they wore yesterday, their usual attire. Everyone looked absolutely exhausted, which was expected after a long night at the movies. They saw a comic book movie. Those were always weird, but Pinkie really seemed to enjoy it, spouting off about her Phase 4 theories or something like that after the film had ended. Sunset didn't know, or just didn't care enough to delve deeper. Twilight adjusted her large glasses, holding on to Spike with both arms and shaking him gently. Spike yawned rather loudly in her arms, Twilight following suit. Even Sunset joined them, turning her weary gaze over to Rainbow Dash, who looked just as tired as everybody else. Sunset Shimmer hated waking up early during the summer, she and all her friends, but it was important. Dash continued, scratching the back of her head. "You're gonna be abandoning us to be spending a week of summer over in another dimension with alternate versions of us, who are actually magical ponies that can talk and fly." Sunset tightened her grip on her bag. "Yeah, that's pretty much it. Albeit minus the abandoning part," Sunset giggled. Rainbow still looked unamused with her answer, crossing her arms and raising a brow. Her cracking voice was weary from the early morning endeavor, even as she said, "So, you're replacing us?" "Rainbow Dash!" Rarity exclaimed, flicking the girl's blue ear. Dash yelped in response, socking Rarity's shoulder, to which she replied with a punch of her own. Before it could escalate, Applejack separated the two, chuckling to herself. Now, calm down, girls," Applejack drawled, pushing the two away and standing between them. She chuckled, tipping her hat to Sunset. "We've known this was coming. Sunset has been planning this here trip for weeks now. Is that right?" "Yep," Sunset said, and brought her bag forward, smiling and reaching into it. She pulled out her journal, flipping randomly through the pages, stopping just after the first few. "I've actually wanted to do this ever since Twilight. Not you, Twilight. Pony Twilight. But first left this world. But never really found the courage or the right time to do so. Mostly the right time to do so." Everyone raised a brow. Sunset frowned. "Okay, I've never really had the courage to do this. But come on, it's kind of, you know, scary having to go back and face every pony you've left. Especially after everything I've done. Especially..." She paused, gripping the book's edges and holding it close to her chest. She sighed. "Especially with my former teacher." The group of seven each shared a saddened look with one another, all eventually turning towards Shimmer. She tightened her jaw, frowned, and nodded. "But my last time meeting with Celestia seemed to go well... back during the whole Memory Stone incident." "Don't remind us," Rainbow growled, crossing her arms. "And Princess Twilight and I have been discussing this for weeks now, and we both decided that now would be the best time to do so. School's out, Equestria has never been safer, and it's just... Sunset sighed again, this time with a smile. Now, it just feels right to do so. It was quiet for a moment, everyone taking in Sunset's words and the beautiful scenery that came with the rising summer sun. Then, Pinky happened. She bounded forward, stopping directly in front of Sunset.
"So, it's a welcome party, then?" she asked, leaning forward, hands behind her back. "That's what you'll be welcomed home to, right? A welcome home party?"
Sunset chuckled. "Well, Twilight did mention that Pinky has been planning something in Equestria." Pinky took that as the biggest breath of fresh air she's ever taken, fist pumping in celebration.
"Yes! Just the right way to do it! Oh, I am good! Even when it's not technically me, I am good!"
Everyone laughed, even Spike, who had decided to wake up fully. That laughter was broken apart when Pinky suddenly lunged forward, wrapping her arms tightly around Sunset and nearly cracking her spine. Sunset caught her breath and nearly dropped her journal, hands pressed down on Pinky, desperately trying to push her away so she could breathe again.
"Oh, please don't stay in Equestria forever!" Pinky cried, tears beginning to form in the corners of her tightly closed eyes. "We have so many plans this summer!"
"Calm down, Pinky!"
Sunset gagged. Pinky took that as a clear sign to ease up. She took in several calming breaths the moment Pinky let loose on her grip, gently patting the girl's pink, fluffy hair.
"It's just for a week, remember? I'll be back before you know it." "It better just be 1 week!" Rainbow exclaimed, stepping forward. "You can't forget our trip to Florida! The waves are gonna be huge this year!" "And our trips to the day spa, darling!"
Rarity shouted, hand held out to the sky.
"And our camping trips," Fluttershy had offered to the conversation,
smiling when everyone shouted in agreement. To each of them, Sunset smiled in response, nodded as well, and said, "I promise." The group shared a massive hug, as if that was her promise being nullified amongst them all. Spike leapt forward and licked Sunset's face. Sunset giggled in response, picking Spike up and hugging him. She handed him back to Twilight once the group broke apart, who turned to Rarity after she stepped forward to Sunset. Watching as Sunset placed her journal back in her bag, Rarity said,
"Who knows? During your time back in Equestria, you can catch up with your parents again."
And just like that, Sunset's smile faded. An awkward silence filled the air, but she didn't pay any attention to her friends or what followed after Rarity's statement. Sunset thought only of her parents. How she hadn't seen them since she left Equestria. She never really had a strong relationship with her family. She dreaded what they must have thought of her now, what with leaving home without warning, stealing Princess Twilight's crown, never visiting or sending letters to them. And now she was coming back, ready to apologize and put the past behind them. But that was just with Celestia. Sunset wouldn't doubt if her parents didn't even know she was coming back. Still, she forced a smile, a sad one, and said,
"Yeah, maybe."
Applejack shoved her elbow into Rarity's side, earning a painful yelp from the girl. Rainbow stuck her tongue out at Rarity, smiling as she did so. Noticing her expression and ignoring the others, Twilight laid her hand on Sunset's shoulder.
"I know you don't like talking about your parents," Twilight said, holding Spike with one arm and caressing Sunset's shoulder with the other. "But if there was ever a time to fully make amends, then you should take every opportunity you can."
Sunset gripped her bag's strap, eyes still not focused upwards. She felt Twilight's grip on her shoulder, how warm it was, how friendly it appeared to be. She smiled at that, finally bringing up her gaze to those glasses and messy purple hair.
"Thanks, Twilight. I'll keep that in mind."
They ended in a hug, quickly followed by everyone else. This group hug lasted longer than the last, not really promising anything, but signifying a strong goodbye and an even stronger friendship.
"We really are gonna miss you," Fluttershy whispered, voice cracking.
"Can you say longest week ever?"
Rainbow exclaimed.
"Longest week ever!"
Pinky screamed. They all laughed and broke away, containing her chuckles. Sunset stared at each of her friends, at the wonderful people she's met, the ones that managed to change her life so much in the best possible way. She really was going to miss them. The last week of school may have been the longest week ever, But deep down, she felt like this next one would be even longer, if that was possible. She kept that in mind as she approached the portal. Looking back, she saw Twilight and the others waving their final goodbyes, even Spike. Twilight gently caressed her geode necklace while holding the little puppy. Sunset felt her own hand move without command toward her neck. She wore her necklace, the red geode with the sun design still embedded within it, gently caressing it at first, then gripping it tightly. Sunset smiled, much more confidently than before. With that confidence, she spun around and slowly entered the portal within the stone block. She held onto her geode even as she swirled through dimensions. Equus, Ponyville, Equestria, home of Princess Twilight Sparkle, 10:09 a.m. Her mind always felt a bit woozy from using the portal, but not this time. Sunset Shimmer was greeted by the unfamiliar feeling of four hooves, a swishing tail, lack of fingers, and a protruding horn from her forehead the moment she stepped out of the light to rub it. She continued to smile as she felt the horn, ensuring her of the portal's continued success. Which also meant... Opening her eyes after entering the bright light and swirling colors, Sunset flinched and allowed herself to adjust to the light before fully opening her eyelids. A stained glass window on the far left of the room was wide open, and bright morning sunlight spilled inside the large library she had seen once before. Within the library, books lined the walls and sat in large piles at the edges of the room, and other than that, the room was spotless. Well, save for 8 colorful spots directly ahead of her. Once her eyes had fully adjusted to the assault of the morning sunlight, Sunset blinked a couple of times and rubbed her eyes. She was met with several smiling faces, ones belonging to Princess Twilight Sparkle, Spike, Starlight Glimmer, Fluttershy, Pinkie Pie, Applejack, Rarity, and Rainbow Dash. On cue to her arrival, Pinkie Pie bounded up and down in a cartoonish fashion, being stopped by Applejack, who draped her hoof across the pony's backside, keeping her to the ground. The farm pony smiled warmly, still holding Pinkie, who could hardly contain her own smile. Rarity fluttered her eyelashes, offering a dazzling smile to the arrival of her fellow unicorn. Fluttershy weakly waved her hoof, hiding half of her face and smile behind her long pink mane. Rainbow hovered above the group, forelegs crossed, smirking and winking down to the unicorn. 3 took a step forward, one of them being Starlight and the others being Spike and Twilight, all of them smiling, Starlight's own being much wider than Spike's. Sunset returned the favor to Twilight. Starlight. She brought her gaze forward, meeting the alicorn's gaze. Sunset flinched, however, when a hulking suit of golden and red armor landed behind the 3 that approached her. Sunset took a cautious step back, eyes widening in shock, horn glowing and at the ready. She was stopped by Twilight's hoof shooting outwards, assuring her of the safety of the situation. Twisting her neck back, Twilight smiled warmly to the large metal suit behind her. Starlight and Spike followed. Sunset just stared, her horn dying. The suit was, as she noticed earlier, colored dark red with hints of gold on its arms, legs, and face. Its eyes and chest glowed a bright blue, the chest especially with its circular design right over where its heart should be. The suit stood taller than the other mares, bringing its gaze down to Princess Twilight. It carried a familiar book with a sun design on its cover. When it spoke, the voice that came out of it completely surprised Sunset. It sounded feminine, a fluid young voice escaping its bulking shape. And it... she said,
"Portal deactivated, Twilight."
Not even her mouth moved when she talked, but Twilight didn't seem all that disturbed. In fact, she smiled and nodded in response, facing the unicorn once more. Managing to bring her gaze away from the suit of armor for a second, Sunset met Twilight's gaze, calming under the princess's warm and welcoming grin. And what she said, "Sunset, welcome home." Sunset Shimmer's smile returned, forming a curious smirk, directed at, yes, the 7 ponies and 1 baby dragon, but more specifically, the Mark 45 Iron Man armor. "Guess you guys have got a bit of a story to tell," Sunset chuckled. Starlight smirked. "You could say that."
Chapter 3. Children of Darkness.
Andromeda Galaxy, Sanctuary. Space was always so beautiful. Thanos liked to imagine that. He knew it wasn't true. Because within that space, within the darkness and the endless void of no return, there was the Blight. An immortal blemish that constantly plagued not only the galaxy he remained, but every galaxy. Every single galaxy. The entire universe, even. That Blight. That blemish. That sickness. It was but one thing. Life. And he stared at it on his throne. He stared into the stardust that ranged from the cool velvet purple to the raging, boiling red. The remains of stars, nothing but dust in the vast open space. They lived their life, expelled their power, and went out. In a flash. So quick. So painless. In such an instant, a life was gone. A life that supplied millions of others on nearby worlds. So fast, it could have been done faster than Thanos could have snapped his fingers. In an instant. Just like that. Thanos' weary gaze turned away from the remains of the stars, and rested to the left side of his throne, to the golden gauntlet that he wore upon his hand. Embedded within it, 6 indents remained, 4 beneath each finger, 1 near his thumb, and the last and the largest on the face of the gauntlet. Perfectly crafted, without fault, created just for him and his destiny. To some, destiny came when it wanted. Sometimes it was meant to be a grand occasion one would have to be patient for in order to reap its full benefits. Others saw destiny as events that are meant to come, unchanged despite the most painful efforts to prevent it. For Thanos, destiny was his to command. He would not wait for the universe to tell him no, to fight back against him and what he saw true. For Thanos, he would seek his destiny and claim it for himself. But for now, that destiny remained on hold. For now, he and his children awaited the return of his army, and their mission that took them years to reach. Thanos had received the word not too long ago from his Chitauri elite that they have found them. They have actually succeeded. Their journey across the universe has yielded its reward, for they have succeeded, and were returning to Thanos to tell him what they found. And now, he and his children just had to wait. His children. The Black Order. This is truly a moment you should be proud of, my great, the Ebony Maw declared, strutting back and forth atop the great mound of space rock, his bony white fingers pressed softly with one another, each hand close together, his eyes lost in hope and wonder. Corvus Glaive sneered from the boulder he sat upon, sharpening his glaive with a short blade, the sparks reflecting off his fangs. Ebony Maw spun around, his attire dancing as he moved to strut forward once again. As we speak, the Outriders return from their journey. In just a short moment, they will inform us of what they have found, and the cleansing will finally become truth. We heard you the first time, Proxima Midnight growled. Ebony Maw turned to her, spotting Midnight sitting by the steps beneath the great throne. In her hand, a 3-pointed spear was pressed to the rock, the tip facing the heavens. Maw stared into her eyes, stared into the madness. At this point, you're just sucking up to Father. Within the shadows, Cull Obsidian chuckled. Not because it was funny, but because the Maw actually flinched to her comment. I just wish for all of you to know of what's to come, Ebony Maw said softly, spinning around and away from Midnight's glare. He held his hands to the heavens, declaring, For we have been blessed to be a part of Thanos' children, to be spared once the cleansing is to begin. And for Father, he paused and turned around to the shadow throne he stared upon. to know that this came to be because of his greatness. This is ridiculous. Ebony Maw looked down to her. You blame the great Titan. I don't blame Father, Midnight said, stepping up to the Maw with spear in hand. Obsidian grunted, stepping out of the shadows and gripping his hammer. Midnight grew closer to the Maw, narrowing her gaze. The Maw didn't move. But it has been years since we have sent the Outriders out to the universe, and only now do they decide to return? They should be lucky we won't slaughter them all when they arrive. If it be at the hands of Thanos, they would be pleased, Ebony said. Midnight smiled, slowly circling the Maw. You grovel like a parasite to Father. Too afraid to speak your mind, too weak to hold your own. She stopped in front of him, eyes meeting his own. Why is it that he likes you more again? Ebony Maw smiled, slowly raising one of his fingers. Several jagged rocks rose from the ground, centering toward Midnight and hovering there. Need I demonstrate? Proxima Midnight bared her teeth, gripping her spear even tighter. In the right side of her vision, she could see Cull Obsidian growing closer, hammer in hand, ready for another warm-up before the cleansing. In the left side of her vision, she saw Corvus Glaive hop down from where he was perched, approaching her. She allowed herself to settle as he came to her side.
Ease yourself, my love,
Corvus Glaive's raspy voice said, resting his claws on Midnight's shoulder. Doing so caused her to settle, just for a moment, and place her spear's end into the ground. Her body became more relaxed. Even the Maw dropped his finger, the jagged rocks falling to the ground. Smiling to that, Corvus looked to Midnight and said,
Let Father deal with these beasts when they arrive. He can be very considerate. That's putting it mildly,
Cull Obsidian growled, stepping back into the shadows. Proxima turned to Glaive, and a smile appeared on her face. Not one of malice or ill intention, but of content. She let her hand drift upwards, caressing Glaive's scar-covered cheek. She sighed.
Of course, my love. You always know what to say.
The two stared into each other's gazes for a moment longer, eventually breaking away when the Maw declared,
Praise be to the great Titan! They have arrived!
In the distance, the Black Order could see as a Chitauri command center approached Sanctuary slowly. It was concealed in the shadows, an asteroid three times the size of it blanketing the entire warship in shadows. And from it, only one ship was launched. The Black Order stepped forward, narrowing their gazes and watching as the ship grew closer and closer. They watched as the Outrider dropship impacted the asteroid beneath the steps leading to the Titan's throne. Debris shot up from the dropship's landing, pieces of asteroid floating off into the void. The ground the Black Order stood upon shook, but then fell into peace and silence. Watching as the dropship began to open beneath them, Corvus Glaive growled, twisting his neck back to the throne.
Thanos!
By that single utterance, the throne slowly turned, away from the asteroid field and the remains of the stars. The throne faced forward, and the mad Titan, Thanos, stared ahead, in silence, watching as Corvus Glaive led his children to the feet of his throne and bowed. They fell to their knees, weapons pressed to the rock, heads held low. Then they rose. Thanos blinked and nodded to them. Other than that, his expression was unreadable. The Ebony Maw took a step forward, standing by Glaive's side. He held out his hands to Thanos, saying,
The Outriders have returned from their journey, my great. Allow them to inform you of what they have discovered.
Thanos nodded once more. His eyes shifted upwards, past the Order and towards the steps spiraling downwards. The Black Order followed their father's gaze, stepping aside as a horde of Outriders poured in from the steps. They arrived in a drove, a mix of limbs and screams following them like the mindless beasts they were. Some trampled over each other, others led the pack, using their claws on each hand, all four of them, to halt several feet ahead of the great throne of Thanos, their master. The Outriders turned their eyeless heads forward, dipping them to the ground. Every Outrider did, until none remained fully standing. Until they all bowed before their master.
"You may speak," Ebony Maw said, a hint of excitement in his tone.
Just the thought of the cleansing growing that much closer made him tingle. Thanos sighed from his throne, resting his chin upon his right hand. Amongst the crowd of shifting forms and low growls, a single Outrider stepped forward on two legs. It was considerably larger than the Outriders surrounding it, holding an extra pair of arms, making the count to six. The Outriders in front backed away as the large Outrider stepped forward to Thanos' throne. It stared straight ahead, growled softly. The Outrider General said,
"We have found them. All of them."
Thanos lifted up his head. The Outriders surrounding the general began to screech in unison, twisting about from where they stood, growling and snapping their jaws. Savages, Proxima Midnight thought to herself, taking several steps backward. A lone Outrider crawled forward. It looked to its general, seeing the nod in confirmation. It approached Thanos' throne, gazing up to its master and saying,
"The Infinity Stone in Asgard was not found. Asgard is destroyed."
Thanos leaned forward.
The Outrider quickly followed up with,
"But the Asgardians still hold it in their Ark. They are on their way to Earth. The Space Stone is in the hands of Loki."
Just the utterance of his name, it caused several Outriders to screech in protest. They slammed their hands into the rock, snapping their teeth together and screaming at that name. The Black Order sneered when the Outrider said his name. Thanos just smiled. He lifted his finger, prompting them to continue. Another Outrider stepped forward, earning a nod from the general, and said,
"The Reality Stone remains with the Collector in nowhere."
Thanos turned to the Outrider, the beast lowering its head to the ground. Then another stepped forward, another nod from the general, and it said,
"The Power Stone is within the vaults of the Nova Corps on Xandar. It is not far from here."
Thanos contemplated that thought, turning to the next Outrider that stepped forward. It turned out that three stepped forward that time. They bowed quickly to their master. The Outrider General looked down, nodding to them. The first of that small pack crawled ahead, lifting up its head and saying,
"We have found two of the Infinity Stones on Earth."
Two? Thanos blinked at that, his brow furrowing. The Outrider next to the first said,
"A Time Stone with the Masters of the Mystic Arts."
The third Outrider hissed,
"The Mind Stone in the forehead of the Vision."
The first Outrider dropped its head, baring its teeth. Each of the Black Order turned to one another, waiting for it to speak, but hearing nothing from the silence of space. The Outriders had fallen silent. None of them spoke. Barely any of them moved. One would assume they had died on the spot under the gaze of the Mad Titan. Not uncommon. Finally, Proxima Midnight asked,
"Well, what of the last stone?"
"The Soul Stone,"
Ebony Maw whispered. His voice traveled to each Outrider, making them all flinch and cower beneath his gaze.
"Where is it?"
The first Outrider lifted its head, its eyeless gaze facing Thanos. It didn't cower. They didn't cower. The first Outrider stood up on its hind legs, slowly stepping forward and pausing, just feet beneath the throne of the great Titan. It could feel the powerful gaze that bore the sight of billions of lives vanquished. It could feel the eyes that watched as the universe tore itself apart, nothing to keep it in balance. It could feel Thanos' gaze rip right through it. And it answered,
"Earth.
The outriders by its sides nodded, hissing together.
Earth!
They chanted.
Earth!
They all did.
Earth!
Until they screamed.
Earth!
Until Ebony Maw raised his finger and silenced them. Proxima Midnight sneered at the beasts before her, her nose wrinkling in disgust. But she couldn't focus on them right now. The location of the Infinity Stones had been given, and it was her turn to take command. To prove herself to Father. She approached the throne, saying, I say we save Earth for last. Xandar is the closest. Shall I prepare the Chitauri, Father? For that, Thanos didn't answer. At least not at first. He left them waiting, in discomfort, in silence as he closed his eyes. The Infinity Stones. All six of their locations found. Since the birth of time itself, the stones could never have been brought together, nor could they have been torn apart from one another. They were caught in a twisted limbo, a hell where trillions of lives had been lost just to gaze at the utter power the stones had. If one could imagine what bringing the six stones together, wielding on all six, could really do. Thanos sighed and opened his eyes. His gaze fell down to the Infinity Gauntlet he wielded in his left palm and forearm. The light of the dying suns caused a soft glow to reflect off the gold-colored plating, the six indents bare and waiting. If one could imagine what bringing the six stones together, if one had the will, the destiny to see it through. No. The Outriders cowered and backed away. The Black Order flinched and did the same. Proxima Midnight backed off, watching as her father rose from the throne and slowly descended the steps. The shadowed throne hid nothing any longer. Thanos' golden armor shined in the light of the residue of the dying stars. His helmet glistened and gleamed as he stepped off the last step and approached the Outriders. The six that remained directly ahead of their general fell to their knees, refusing to look up unless told so. And they waited. Thanos looked to them, then to his empty gauntlet. His violet skin didn't even flinch to the aspect of its nakedness. He knew it would be sealed soon, with power beyond comprehension, with power that no one in the entire universe could ever imagine, with power that he would wield, even if it cost him everything, if one had the will to see it through. And so Thanos spoke, still holding a lost gaze at the Infinity Gauntlet.
For years, I had every opportunity to find what I needed. And every single time, those opportunities were stripped away. I could have accomplished it so much earlier. I could have seen my destiny so much sooner.
Thanos flexed his left palm, the gauntlet's metal plating clenching. He frowned at the sight of the empty indents.
I have been played a fool two times too many. No more. The time for rest is over. Watching as the universe wastes away is something I can no longer bear. It's time to take what is rightfully mine. And it begins by fulfilling a deal with the adopted son of Odin.
He dropped his hand, and more so the gauntlet. Turning to Proxima Midnight, he said,
Ready my ship.
She nodded without question, the rest of the Black Order following her as she went to obey her father's command. However, they were stopped. They, as well as the Outrider General and all of its followers. They stopped and watched the scene unfold beneath the throne.
And as for you six,
Thanos said, eyes landing on the six Outriders still kneeling before him. They lifted up their heads upon hearing their Lord and Master address them. Thanos reached behind him with his right hand.
I believe a reward is an order for your cause.
From his back, Thanos unsheathed a massive blade and brought it forward. The Outrider's jaw fell together, their claws held out to their master and to the blade he wielded. Thanos observed his reflection, saw the stardust and the trillions of light glinting off of its surface. He turned the blade right, then brought it left, then sliced downwards in less than a second. So fast. So clean. Six heads shot up and fell down with the bodies. The Outrider screamed in joy. The general held out one of its many hands to the Mad Titan. The several others beneath it did the same, thanking him, praising him. The Black Order, Proxima Midnight, Corvus Glaive, Ebony Maw, and Cull Obsidian just stared. Stared and smiled. Thanos slid his blood-covered blade into the holster on his back, stepped over the bodies, and began his holy quest. Chapter 4. Making Amends. Milky Way Galaxy. Equus. Ponyville, Equestria. Home of Princess Twilight Sparkle. 9:13 p.m. The party started mere hours after Sunset Shimmer stepped hoof into Twilight's library. She hardly had any time to set her bag in the guest room Twilight provided, or even walk around the castle before guests started pouring in. Being a party hosted by the Princess of Friendship herself, plenty of high members from Canterlot and even some celebrities managed to drop by. Sunset barely knew any pony, but every pony seemed to know her. The folks from Canterlot, particularly Fancy Pants and the lovely Fleur de Lis, just gabbled on and on about Princess Twilight's stories from another dimension. She particularly spoke highly of Sunset Shimmer, causing the unicorn to blush whenever it was something positive. It always was. No pony seemed to mention her past, almost as if it never happened. Part of Sunset wished for that. The other part knew that wouldn't be possible, and accepted that. Though she wasn't fond of it, the past still happened, and she still lived with that. Her past wasn't today, however. It didn't define her now. Several celebrities managed to drop by for a quick visit. Some Sunset barely remembered, others that were completely new to her. She, of course, remembered Countess Coloratura, who went by Rara now. She mostly chatted with Applejack, but spent a good portion of the night meeting Sunset. The unicorn also met Songbird Serenade for the first time. Apparently, she was a new pop artist that sprang up a couple years back. She knew Twilight from when she and her friend saved Canterlot from the Storm King's invasion not too long ago. That earned Sunset's attention, something she'll definitely have to discuss further about with Twilight. Even some of the students from Twilight's School of Friendship dropped by with their respected guardians. Sunset had trouble remembering all of their names, but she managed. The first was Sandbar, a young earth pony who obviously had a crush on Sunset the moment he laid eyes on her. Sunset could catch the hints. Then there was Silverstream, a hippogriff of all creatures, who couldn't stop freaking out over the fact that Sunset had been to another dimension. Her guardian turned out to be General Seaspray, one of Queen Novo's naval leaders. Then there was Ocellus, a shy changeling hiding under the legs of Thorax, the leader of said changelings. Sunset really enjoyed his company. Next was Smolder, accompanied by Dragon Lord Ember. Strange. The last Sunset heard was that the dragons tried to keep as far away from ponies as possible. Something must have changed. Something she should discuss with Princess Twilight. Then there were the yaks, two in particular. The smaller one's name was Yona, who almost crushed Sunset with her hug. Then there was Prince Rutherford. He made it abundantly clear, very loudly to be exact, that he welcomed Dimension Pony into Equestria. Sunset's ears couldn't stop ringing. And finally, there was Gallus, and what appeared to be his grandfather Griffin, rightfully named Grandpa Gruff. One was smug, and the other practically coughed his lungs out right in front of the unicorn. Sunset tried to keep her smile the entire time. None of the students or their guardians stayed very long. They met Sunset, offered their greetings and goodbyes to Princess Twilight and her friends, and left to their respective lands. all except for Sandbar, who Sunset could have sworn was following her for at least an hour before his parents finally arrived to drag him home. Sunset just laughed as he waved longingly goodbye. The party started off slow, but once the moon started to rise, that's when things started to really kick off. More guests arrived by the dozen, and every pony present was visited by the spirit of chaos and disharmony himself, Discord. The guests from Ponyville especially enjoyed his appearance. They had particular experience when dealing with Discord's antics, what with the party Discord threw a couple years back in Ponyville that left the town in shambles. Sunset found Discord to be quite the charmer, but also kind of a whack job. He took both as compliments. As the party dragged on and the celebrities came and went, things started to slow down into the night. The castle wasn't as crowded as it had been earlier that night, but there were still a good number of ponies filling the halls. Trash lied on empty tables in the dining area, empty plates and cups being thrust into garbage pails by Spike and several other ponies. Small conversations filled the castle, ponies sticking to small groups and chatting amongst themselves, until they had decided when it would be best to turn in for the night. Others, the more knowledgeable ones, knew Pinkie Pie had at least one more trick up her sleeve, and chose to prepare by finishing off their drinks and moving toward the dining area for a refill. These ponies waved to Sunset as she strode past them. Sunset Shimmer tried to find her way through Twilight's castle, through the dining area and entering the maze-like hallways. She frowned. The last time she was in Twilight's castle, all she saw was the library and a few hallways. Sure, it was big, but she couldn't have imagined it was so large on the inside with how it appeared on the outside. She tried to keep her mind on the physical attributes of Twilight's castle, and not on what she had been both anxiously waiting for and dreading all night. Making amends once again. There wasn't any sign of the princesses, nor of Twilight, who Sunset had been looking for after breaking herself away from the conversation in the dining area. She was grateful there were so many ponies who were willing to accept and meet her, but a few minutes of breathing room to gain some insight on her current mission was desperately needed. The library closed off for the night, so no finding Twilight in there. None of the guest rooms were occupied, and the throne room was blocked off from all guests. Aside from some lingering ponies in the hallways, the only other place in the castle that she knew ponies would have to be in the foyer, directly next to the entrance of the castle. She found her way there rather easily, standing at the top of the stairway and gazing down at a room that was nearly full of ponies. Discord was present, which earned most of the attention of the room. Sunset didn't pay the bystanders any attention, though. Her full gaze was latched with Twilight chatting with some friends from Canterlot. The rest of her friends were scattered throughout the foyer, speaking with close friends and family. Especially Starlight, who was engrossed with the tale of adventure and excitement that Trixie, Derpy, and Maud were trying to tell her. Well, mostly Trixie and Derpy. Maud just stood by with her younger sister, Pinkie, listening and offering her own slice of the adventure she, Trixie, and Derpy had been a part of. Her words were minimal, yet the story was so fascinating. Sunset definitely needed to hear about their little space adventure. Definitely later. Now, she needed to focus on just one pony. Oh, Sunset Shimmer! Nearly jumping out of her coat, Sunset spun her neck around, her mane whipping with her. She smiled in relief to only see Spike behind her, quickly making his way down the steps. Oh, Spike, you can call me Sunset. No need for such formalities, she told him with a giggle and a wave of her hoof. Stopping just a few steps above her, Spike frowned, rubbing the back of his head. Right, sorry. It's just that Twilight wants me to be on my best behavior tonight, and... Everything seemed to click shortly after he said Twilight's name. He snapped his claws, turning to Sunset with a smile and eyes brimming with excitement. Oh, that's right! Twilight wanted me to find you and bring you to the foyer. But it looks like you already found your way, so my last job for the party is nearly done. He offered his claw and bowed respectively. My lady? Sunset chuckled and placed her hoof in his claw. Don't call me that, she said with a deadpan tone, but smirked Spike's way. They descended the stairs and entered the foyer, passing ponies and making their way near the doors, where Twilight was speaking with several other ponies. The whole time she tried not to look at the small wings protruding from Spike's back. instantly, Twilight's eyes widened with excitement when she spotted Sunset's bright mane. "Sunset!" Twilight exclaimed, breaking away from the group she was speaking with, all of which turned their attention onto Sunset. "I'm so glad you're here! You came just in time!" "Wait, it is time, isn't it?" Spike nodded to her, tapping his watch. "Great!" Twilight said with a giddy smile, hopping on the tips of her hooves like a little filly. Several of her friends from Canterlot, such as Moondancer, Twinkleshine, Lemonhearts, and Minuet, all giggled at her reaction. "Oh, I can't wait! This reunion is going to be fantastic, I just know it!" Stepping forward and away from Spike, who joined in on another far-off conversation, Sunset chuckled nervously, rubbing her foreleg. "That's actually what I wanted to talk with you about, Twilight." Twilight paused for a moment, smiled warmly, then turned to the four behind her. "Excuse me, girls," she told them, facing Sunset and stepping aside with her. "Yeah? So what's on your mind?" "Do you remember when I came back during the Memory Stone incident, right?" Sunset asked, nearly at a whisper. Twilight nodded, her smile fading and a worrisome expression growing on her face. "So you should probably know that I've already kinda made amends with Celestia already. Sure, I've done some pretty terrible things, said even worse things to Celestia herself. So what do I even need to say?" Twilight's worry vanished when Sunset mentioned Celestia. She just smiled in response, resting her hoof on Sunset's shoulder. She noticed it was shaking. "Well, that's always difficult," she told her in the kindest tone she could manage for her. "Although you did meet with Celestia and apologized already, it wouldn't hurt to do it again. By the way, you didn't really stay in Equestria that long." Sunset nodded slowly at first. "I guess you're right." That nod quickened, her smile growing as she exclaimed, "Yeah, I'm worrying over nothing. It's gonna be easy." Smiling in response to that, Twilight leaned her bent neck back as Sunset moved in, brown furrowing. The unicorn whispering, "By the way, when did you say the princesses were getting here?" Three sudden and powerful knocks on the door brought every pony's attention backwards to the entrance of the castle. Before any pony could intervene, the Mark 45 Iron Man armor flew over every pony's heads, landing in front of the twin doors and pulling them open. The AI nodded her metallic head, stepping aside to announce loudly for the entire foyer to hear. And Friday said,
"Presenting the rulers of Equestria, the Princess of the Sun and the Princess of the Moon, Celestia and Luna, as well as their guest for the night."
Sunset's confident smile fell, replaced only with a confused expression. "Guests?" she asked. Twilight could hardly contain her excitement. That confused expression was then replaced with a look of surprise when she forgot who Friday just mentioned by name. They stepped into the castle, looking as elegant as ever, Celestia mostly. The dark blue alicorn standing on her right was obviously Princess Luna. Sunset, like every pony else, knew of the story of Nightmare Moon. She knew Luna had returned, but it was still just the second time she had met her, face to face. The two were trailed by a few royal guards who kept the doors open, despite the fact that the princesses had already made it inside. Twilight and the ponies around her began to move forward. The entire foyer began to move forward. Sunset stayed where she was, eyes trained on the bright white alicorn, and she shivered. "Your Highnesses," Twilight greeted, bowing to the royal sisters. Every pony else in the foyer followed in the princess's footsteps, save for Discord and Sunset Shimmer. She eventually snapped out of her daze and bowed like the others. She could have sworn she saw Celestia's warm smile turn her way. She gulped nervously, already sweating with her snout nearly touching the floor. Nodding to Friday behind her, the AI doing just the same before flying off to the end of the room, Celestia turned her attention forward.
"Princess Twilight, I must say this is quite the impressive celebration you've thrown," Celestia addressed, smiling to the rest of the room.
Every pony stood back up. Leaning down to her past pupil, Celestia whispered,
"I see your organizational skills from the previous galas have helped."
Chuckling in response, Twilight nodded.
Certainly, Celestia, she said, stepping aside and looking back for the right mare.
She saw her standing amongst the crowd, almost looking like she was unsure whether she should back away or remain frozen. Twilight smiled warmly.
There is some pony here who has been dying to see you again. I think it would all be in our best interests.
Twilight paused, turning back to gaze right into Celestia's eyes, the twin orbs that held the radiance of the rising sun.
If we let her speak.
Celestia's smile almost broke. She forced herself to keep it, but even Twilight saw that slight falter.
So I have heard, the Princess of the Sun said, following Twilight's gaze.
Every pony followed Celestia's eyes, straight to the unicorn now at the center of attention. Sunset instantly crumbled on the inside by the sudden attention shifted her way.
Really didn't imagine it going this way,
she thought, taking the first few and very brave steps forward. She had hoped for a smaller crowd, preferably just Twilight and her friends as witnesses. She tried not to focus on them, and instead focused on...
Princess Celestia?
Sunset asked, the bravery in her voice still standing strong. The Princess of the Sun awaited the unicorn's approach with the brightest smile she could offer. Her mane danced to the flow of the wind that wasn't there, sparkling in the shade of the rainbow it was.
Sunset shimmer,
Celestia said sweetly, smiling to the unicorn as she slowly approached her. She noticed the shake in her step, causing her to chuckle warmly.
It is a true pleasure to see you once again.
She shot out her wing, causing Sunset to flinch back and shut her eyes, almost like she was preparing for a strike to come. Nothing did. Instead, she opened her eyes to be met with Celestia's smile, and her left wing opened up to her, almost like an embrace awaiting her arrival. Sunset was cautious for a short time, but the longer she stared at Celestia's smile, that same warm, motherly smile, tears began to well up in the corners of her eyes. Tears she couldn't stop, just like how she couldn't stop what came next. The unicorn ran forward and clutched onto the princess's chest like it was her lifeline, already releasing the waterworks right into the alicorn's chest. Even when she spread her dampness onto her coat, even when she bawled like a little filly, Celestia didn't turn her away or break the embrace. She sealed it. Sunset felt the large wing drape over her like a comforting blanket, like a shield to keep her safe. Just like before. Just like so long ago when she was still her pupil. The thought of that caused Sunset to clutch onto her chest and cry even harder.
I'm sorry,
the unicorn cried, face buried into Celestia's chest.
I'm so sorry. I wish I could take it all back.
Oh, my little pony, Celestia said, her voice nearly breaking as she rubbed the unicorn's mane.
It's okay. Everything's all right.
Sunset looked up at her, tears staining her cheeks and burning her eyes. Celestia only smiled, saying in a soothing tone,
From what I've heard, there is no need for apologies, Sunset.
She lifted her gaze and brought it to Twilight and the approaching elements of harmony. Even as she stared at them, she spoke to Sunset.
Your actions in the other world, everything you've done to make amends, all of the wonderful friends you've made and problems you've solved all in the name of friendship, it has all proven that you have changed, in the most wonderful of ways.
Using her wings, she wiped away Sunset's tears, but that didn't stop more from flowing freely. Even Celestia couldn't shield her own. She bent down and practically scooped the unicorn into her forelegs, holding her as if she was her own daughter.
Welcome home, Sunset Shimmer.
Sunset could hear the shaking in Celestia's voice, almost causing more tears to spring up in her eyes. But she stopped them, wiping her nose with a foreleg and breaking away from the princess. Celestia smiled to her.
Thank you, Princess Celestia.
Sunset said, sniffing loudly before turning to her left, where the Princess of the Night stood with a grin. Sunset nearly jumped, rubbing her eyes rather quickly.
Princess Luna, it's great to see you again.
The alicorn nodded and began to speak, addressed Sunset as fluently as she could, so clear that every pony could hear her.
I must say, it is an honor to be speaking to the one most highly praised by Princess Twilight once more. And I think it goes to show that any friend of my sister's is most certainly a friend of mine.
Before Sunset could reply, Luna stepped forward for a hug. At first, Sunset was uncertain, but slowly fell into it when Celestia's calming smile egged her on. Sunset chuckled, breaking away from the princess.
Thank you, Your Highness, she said to Luna, who smiled and nodded in response.
How are the faculty lots? Luna asked. Sunset actually laughed at that. Luna's smile dwindled, confusion rippling across her brow.
Was it something I said?
As much as I would love for this reunion to last, it would be disrespectful to not introduce Sunset to our guests for the evening, Celestia said, stepping forward with her sister.
Oh, I wholeheartedly agree, sister, Celestia, Luna said, smirking to Sunset.
Catching that smirk and not knowing what to do with it, Sunset took a step forward and said,
Yeah, Friday mentioned something about get...
Both princesses backed away, making room for their guests as they entered through the large doors of Twilight's castle. The doors closed at long last, finally revealing why they had remained open for so long. Sunset's voice completely failed her, her eyes widening to a size she almost couldn't fathom. She caught her breath, almost failing to breathe, but did so in small, silent bursts. Her heart practically stopped dead in its tracks, her mind almost doing the same. When her parents stepped through those doors and entered Twilight's castle, Sunset didn't move. She didn't breathe for a moment, then shortly continued. She didn't think, just stood in complete and utter shock. Sunrise and evening shimmer nearly shared the exact same fate. Despite knowing full well why they were brought by the princesses themselves to Princess Twilight's castle that night, the mare and stallion almost couldn't believe who was standing just mere feet in front of them. Sunrise Shimmer, Sunset's father, was a golden unicorn with a dull red mane and heavy wrinkles under his eyes, which were colored a light orange. He stood frozen in time, jaw unhinged, as did his wife. Evening Shimmer gasped loudly, trying to hide her shrieks with a raised hoof. Unlike her husband, her coat was a darker shade of gold, and her mane a slight, light shade of yellow and dark orange. She had her daughter's eyes, bright cyan, just like Sunset's. Sunset quickly looked over to Twilight. The alicorn smiled as wide as ever, her eyes almost burning with tears as her hoof rose to cover her mouth. Those eyes of hers, just like Celestia, egged her on, pushed her forward. Almost unsure at first, Sunset took those brave steps of hers forward. Between the royal sisters and towards the pony, she was even more terrified to see than Celestia. Neither of them moved, just stood in tense silence as their daughter approached them. Each step was harder than the last, each inch closer a tug at Sunset's heart after seeing the expressions on her mother's face. Her father remained frozen in his own way, expression solidified into absolute nothingness. She didn't care if there was a crowd anymore. She forgot about them a long time ago. She stopped at a distance that she felt was right, just a few feet between them. Sunset didn't smile, didn't say a thing, but stand and stare. That couldn't even last when she saw her mother break down into tears. That tore her apart, the dam breaking and releasing the flood. The rivers flowed free once more when her mother shot forward and clutched onto her with a certain warmness that she hadn't felt in a long time. My baby, Evening whimpered, causing Sunset to start bawling when that voice touched her ears. She brought up her forelegs and embraced her mother, her wavering strength just being enough. Even through the tears, she could see her father follow shortly, his chin resting on her opposite shoulder as he held onto his only daughter. Sunset cried. She didn't care anymore. She cried like she never had before, even worse than when Twilight reformed her, because back then she was being brought out of the darkness. Now she was being brought back into the life she left, one she never wanted to leave again. She felt her father bring up his hoof, gently rubbing her mane.
So sorry, Mom,
Sunset whimpered, breaking into more tears as she buried her face in her father's mane.
I'm so sorry, Dad.
Oh, baby girl,
her father whispered, kissing her mane. It's okay. It's all right. If you're going to leave, her mother said, breaking away but still keeping her hooves pressed firmly to her daughter. Please tell us when you're coming back. Sunset managed a tear-stained smile. Okay. I promise. They all fell back into another hug, and right away Sunset knew that all the bad blood they had before was washed clean, leaving nothing but a clean slate for her to rebuild. It was perfect. It was just so absolutely perfect. So, Sunset, Celestia said, stepping forward, is it all you imagined a warm, welcome home would be? She managed to pry her mother's and father's hooves off of her for a short period, chuckling at them, who smiled back to her. Turning to Celestia, the reunited family smiled, only Sunset Shimmer nodding. And she said, it's even better than I could have imagined. It's about to get even better, Sunset, Pinky declared, bounding forward and becoming the new center of attention. Because starting right now, the Sunset Shimmer Welcome Home, We're Glad You're Not a Villain Anymore party extravaganza after party has officially begun! She blew her party cannon after that announcement, spreading confetti all across the room. It covered party guests, the princesses, and Sunset and her family, yet it earned the biggest hoot and holler that the night could offer. Pinkie Pie stood tall in her smoking party cannon, waving a bright orange flag with Sunset's cutie mark etched on its face. The three unicorns laughed at the pony's antics, watching as she turned to them. Woohoo! Better stack up on the sugar, Mr. and Mrs. Shimmer, because we're going all night long! Pinkie screamed. Every pony cheered. Every pony except Spike, who was looking forward to turning in for the night. Now he had an after-party to attend to. The small dragon sat on the steps leading to the hallways, sighing and letting his head fall back on the upper steps, his wings resting flat. A certain spirit of chaos wasn't even enough to get him up. Oh, Spike, you simply must try the refreshments, Discord exclaimed, hovering a glass filled with popping liquid into Spike's limp claw. Discord took a large sip out of his own, sighing and smacking his lips. I added a little something here and there to ours just to give them that much of a kick in the aftertaste. Twilight wouldn't let me anywhere near the punch bowl, so I had to sneak these. She has been on my case all night, you wouldn't believe. Sighing once more, Spike leaned forward, his spikes drooping to his side. He didn't even look into the drink as he clutched the glass with both claws. Tell me about it, he muttered, heavy bags under his eyes. He watched Twilight being introduced by Sunset to the unicorn's parents, laughing and having a great time. It's like she forgot about his job, or his entire existence. Wouldn't be the first time. Discord leaned close to his cheek, sipping on his floating glass. He sighed again, not with content, but with sadness. There they are, the mares that rule this nation. And here we are, just players trying to get through the game, he said, paw held out to Celestia, Luna, and Twilight. The rest of his body lay wilting like a shed python skin on the steps. Spike yawned, looking down at his bubbling drink. He downed it all in one gulp. His weariness left him, the dragon's eyes widening, his voice rising. You said it, he declared, staring into his empty cup, almost as if he was searching for another drop. Discord caught the look and smirked. I thought you might like the drink. Now we can groovy all night long. However, Spike began to feel dizzy, hiccuping and stumbling to his feet. Discord caught him before he could fall down the steps. He froze in horror, hiding the dragon from the eyes of such ponies like Twilight, or worse, Fluttershy. On second thought, giving that mixture to someone underage was probably a bad idea, he whispered to himself, looking down to the baby dragon drooling face first on the steps. Do you want to go lie down instead? Would you like that, lizard? Spike turned his head and shook it. Want to go to the balcony and point obscene gestures at ponies leaving the party? Spike nodded lazily, burping flames. Okay, let's go on to the balcony and point obscene gestures at ponies leaving the party. Discord said, dragging the baby dragon under his tail, out the door and out of the party. He shut the door with his own tail, but not before muttering under his breath, it's more fun than this boar fest anyhow.
Chapter 5. Space. Asgard. The statesmen en route to Earth. They came without warning. in a shadow, blocking out the rays of a nearby star and covering the entire ship in darkness. Thor, Odin's son, the king of Asgard, and his brother, Loki, Odin's son, did their best to maintain control of the ship and the situation as a whole. It fell apart in mere moments. The two stumbled throughout the many corridors of the Statesman, lights flickering as every explosion and tremor rocked the ship. Droves of Asgardian citizens sped forward and past them, carrying supplies, weapons, and whatever else to the fight. To the fight for their very survival. Many others carried their children opposite to where Thor and Loki went. So many others. So many families. Another tremor hit the ship. A devastating explosion felt beneath their feet. Everyone fell and screamed, minus Thor, who gripped onto the nearest support beam to stabilize himself. Loki shot up his head from where he lay, seeing the blue lights flicker on and off, barely staying on. The ship barely holding as their enemy relentlessly attacked. "We need to ready the escape pods," Loki offered, turning to his brother for support. The tone in his voice and the look in his eyes told Thor that he wasn't planning on getting the civilians out first. Unfortunately, Thor thought otherwise. He shook his head, growling, "No! We stay and fight! These are our people, Loki! We will not leave them to die!" As Loki got to his feet, he turned to Thor, smiling. Thor always hated that smile. He always hated Loki when he made it. "I meant for the civilians, of course," Loki said. Thor snorted. "You're unbelievable." Before he could offer his clever retort, Thor grabbed him by the back of the neck and shoved him along. The two brothers continued to push through the crowds of screaming Asgardians, finally entering the main bridge of the Statesman. Once inside, the two instantly noticed the massive alien warship through the glass window directly ahead. Its ominous presence blocked the stars and cast a pitch-black shadow throughout the entire bridge. They made their way by sight of the flickering lights and following the screams. "Heimdall!" The Watcher of Worlds responded by twisting his glowing orange eyes to the approaching Asgardian king. In his hands, he held the sword that once lighted the Bifrost, now used as his last means of defense against the approaching warship and what was soon to follow. He gripped his blade, Hofund, that much lighter, approaching the son of Odin. "My king," Heimdall said. "The enemy warship approaches. No doubt they'll be planning to come aboard. We are willing to defend the bridge, but we'll need a leader." Upon hearing that brave sentiment, Thor looked to what Heimdall referred to as we. Asgardian civilians, taking arms against, alongside Sakaaran gladiators, willing to do whatever it takes to protect the ship, their families, and their own lives. Thor nodded, turning back to Heimdall. "You have two." He turned to his left. Loki tried to laugh, his smile being all that remained. He looked down. He wasn't ready for the sword thrust toward him by Heimdall. Barely catching it, Loki turned to the Watcher of Worlds. Heimdall gripped Hofund, swung it around with ease and precision, and said, "We are running out of time. The remaining civilians cannot stay on this ship by the time our enemies board. Ready the escape pods! Women and children first!" Thor ordered to a pair of Asgardians. They nodded, retreating to the corridors. With that settled, Thor and Loki stood close by Heimdall, glaring into the glass window and the alien warship that remained hovering dangerously close. It wouldn't be long now. The Asgardians and Sakaarans readied themselves, holding their ground against their king and each other. "Could you ever have imagined we would be fighting for our lives after all the hell we've been through?" Loki asked. Thor just cracked his neck, his only good eye watching the invading warship approach so very slowly.
"No, the thought never crossed my mind," Thor answered sarcastically.
He tightened his fists, spurts of electricity dancing across his knuckles.
"But life keeps finding a way."
Loki nodded, staring forward. He twirled the sword in front of him, unveiling a dagger in his free hand.
"So it does."
They readied themselves for the impending onslaught. The shadow that the warship cast led up to their feet, blanketing their legs and devouring their entire bodies. The Asgardians crowded closer together, tightening their grips on their weapons. The Sakaaran gladiators twisted their heads to and fro, the growing silence eating away at their nerves. Thor, Loki, and Heimdall stood at the ready, waiting. But they flinched when the screams came from behind them.
My king! My king! Thor spun around. So did Loki. So did everyone. The Asgardians Thor had sent off came sprinting back inside the main bridge. One of them screamed, "The escape pods have been destroyed! Enemies have breached the ship!" By that time, the bridge exploded, and three massive pods bore themselves within the statesman. The Asgardians flew back from the explosion, fire and smoke raining on top of them. Thor, Loki, and Heimdall were lost through the smoke, their bodies launched backwards from the force of the eruption within the bridge. Thor quickly rose to his feet, narrowing his single eye through the smoke. Electricity danced across his forearms, ready to strike to the first body that charged him. Even if he wasn't ready, all he saw was the golden gauntlet fly through the smoke and strike him across the face. Then came the screams, and no one heard them. Who could? Korg wasn't one for life and death situations. He was more of a gentle giant, per se, only fighting when it counted. And that would have been when he warmed up the crowd back on Sakaar for the Grandmaster's gladiatorial arena. Now, with the revolution a full success this time around, and a brand new life ahead of him with his pal Meek by his side, he could look forward to a nice, long, peaceful life. None of that counted anymore when the alien spaceship attacked them. Following the destruction of the escape pods, but with two pods breaking inside the ship and two aliens popping out of them, Korg only saw it fit to round up the civilians somewhere safe. He got a little help on the way, too. Watching as every last Asgardian citizen pushed the door and entered the massive supply room of the statesman, Korg closed the door with his free hand. His other was currently occupied holding his friend Meek, the poor Sakaaran still lacking the appropriate limbs to walk all on his own.
"Here, can you hold Meek, man?" Korg asked, already plopping Meek into an Asgardian's unprepared arms.
The Asgardian fell backwards, Meek's form lying on top of him. Korg didn't see it, because he was too focused on keeping control of the situation that had already gotten out of hand. And had gone south. Very, very south. Watching as several Asgardians tended to their families, the Sakaaran gladiators that followed Korg since the revolution on Sakaar stood at the ready, turning to Korg for the next plan. He barely had one. Instead, he said,
"All right, men, got bad news and good news. The bad news is that we lost all the escape pods, and the only thing keeping our enemies away from us and the hundreds of civilians is that door over there."
Everyone spun their heads accordingly to the lone set of doors directly behind Korg. "Well?" Korg looked at an Asgardian behind the Sakaaran gladiators.
"What's the good news?" he asked.
Korg snapped his fingers.
"Oh yeah, the good news is that we have a Hulk."
The Hulk roared. Everyone flinched and spun around to the massive green beast stumbling about in the center of the room. He snarled, turning to Korg and clenching his fists, ready for quite possibly anything that was coming after them. Korg nodded, all heads in the room slowly turning back his way.
Pretty good news right there.
"And you have me," a voice declared, causing Korg to spin around. She opened the door and let herself in, her stunning blue cape covered in blood and other filth. Her slim white armor fared no better, covered in cuts and scorch marks. As she locked the door, she turned to Korg and approached him, blade in hand, fury in her eyes.
"You didn't even lock the door."
Ignoring that statement, Korg pointed to her, saying,
"Oh, I didn't forget about you. I just forgot your name, is all."
She jammed her blade towards him, his stone hands rising up.
"Call me Valkyrie Rock,"
Valkyrie stated, turning her blade away from him and towards the door behind her.
"You're gonna need it when you're screaming for help." "Hey man, this is a team effort,"
Korg said, lowering his hands, then gesturing them to the Asgardians and Sakaarans behind him.
"I mean, I know we're not much to look at, but we got what our enemies do not."
Valkyrie looked back, raising a brow. "A Hulk?" From behind, Hulk snarled, stomping around, turning to every wall and anticipating the next attack. Korg nodded to that.
"Well, yes, that is important. But most importantly, we have the fighting spirit of those who survived countless months on Sakaar, fighting for the pleasure of the Grandmaster until their bones would break and their blood would spill. We have the survivors of Asgard itself, facing complete and total annihilation of their home and still having the courage to fight another day and protect the ones they love. If that isn't true strength, if that isn't something our enemies should fear, then I don't know what..."
The doors, the walls, and the room
practically exploded. Several screams resounded through the madness, bodies being launched backwards like ragdolls. Korg, Valkyrie, and several others were unfortunate enough to be a part of them. As they hit the ground, as the explosion ceased and smoke filled the room, everyone began to pick themselves up. Valkyrie was the first, unsheathing a second blade and standing low, eyeing the smoke where the doors once stood. From behind her, she heard Korg cough.
Yeah, probably should have saved the speech for later. Sorry about that.
Get ready! Valkyrie cried, swords wielded in each hand. Here they come! Korg got back up, cocked his Sakaran laser rifle, and nodded. The Asgardian civilians picked themselves, scrounged for their weapons that were scattered following the explosion, and stood at the ready. They couldn't hide the fear in their eyes, or the shake in their step, but they stood, between what lied in the smoke and their families. The Hulk stomped forward, roaring loud enough to shake the entire ship. Through the smoke, the head of a large hammer soared through, a heavy string of solid chain attached to it. The hammer's head struck the Hulk square in the face, knocking him across the room. The Asgardian civilians barely got out of the way in time, the Hulk crashing into the ground, and at the end of the room, the hammer's head went flying backwards into the smoke. And next came the owner of said hammer. Cull Obsidian ran through the smoke, bellowing his own roar, and they weren't even ready. Valkyrie barely was. She rolled out of the way, allowing Obsidian to stampede into the room and avoid crushing her. Korg fired away from his rifle, the lasers doing nothing against Cull's armor. He smacked the Cronin with his hammer, Korg losing his rifle and being launched into the opposite wall, where he hit with a solid crack and fell to the floor below. Valkyrie watched as the massive alien went right for the crowds of civilians. She got back up and charged him, only to nearly get her head sliced clean off her shoulders when the shimmering blue blade was swung for her neck. Valkyrie slid on her knees, watching the blade skim the skin on her nose, and twisted herself around to face her assailant. Proxima Midnight brought her spear back, smiling to the Asgardian Valkyrie. And she said,
"I thought Hela killed all you Valkyries."
Valkyrie cracked her neck, twirling her blades.
"Guess she missed one."
"I won't." And then they charged. The Asgardian's precision and fluid strikes and swings with her twin blades did little against the member of the Black Order. Proxima Midnight dodged, blocked, and delivered her own devastating swipes, jabs and swings that Valkyrie only barely managed to dodge. Proxima jammed the three-pointed edge of her spear right for Valkyrie's head. She dodged just in time, but was still unprepared for Midnight's leg rising up and striking her abdomen. Valkyrie lost her breath, looking up to see Proxima jam her palm right into her throat and slam her into the ground, causing her to drop her blades. As if Valkyrie had enough difficulty breathing, Midnight slammed the bottom of her foot into her throat. Valkyrie instantly shot up, gripping Proxima's foot and proceeding to twist it in order to get her off. She halted her actions when the three tips of the spear were held dangling over her head, two points aimed for the eyes, the other her mouth. Directly above, Valkyrie could see Midnight smirk. It was one of victory, and Valkyrie knew it.
"Shit!"
she whispered, then gagged as Midnight pressed further into her throat. In the remainder of the madness, Cull Obsidian slaughtered all who stood in his way, from the terrified Asgardians doing everything in their power to keep the behemoth away from the families, from the Sakaran gladiators who never even stood a chance against the strongest member of the Black Order. None of them succeeded. None of them were the Hulk. Just before he could bring his hammer down on a group of unarmed civilians, a green blur tackled him from the side, driving Obsidian to the opposite end of the room and nearly through the wall. Cull grunted in pain, glaring upwards and snarling like a feral beast. The fist to his face silenced that. It was followed up by another, then another, and again, and again, and again. The Hulk unloaded every ounce of his anger on the alien, roaring louder with each punch, driving Cull Obsidian deeper into the wall. Then Hulk backed away. Cull Obsidian remained where he was, unmoving but groaning in pain. He dropped his hammer long ago, the weapon resting on the floor by Hulk's bare feet and pieces of the wall he was punched into. The Hulk snorted, wiping the green splatter of blood under his nose with his forearm, backing away from the wall and the carnage he left.
"Banner, look out!"
Spinning to the voice, the Hulk bellowed to see Valkyrie in trouble, beneath the foot of another alien. He didn't react in time. He was too focused on her to see the spear sent his way. He could react to the pain that followed, to the spear tearing through his chest. The Hulk stopped, caught his breath, and stood frozen in time. Slowly, painfully looking down, he could see the spear jutting outwards, the three-pointed edge stuck in his chest and green blood pouring out from the wound. The Hulk coughed, more blood spilling from his mouth as he slowly reached up and gripped the spear. He didn't pull it out. An unknown force ripped the weapon right out of his chest and flew back into the awaiting hands of Proxima Midnight. A splatter of blood trailed between them, colored a sickly dark green. The Hulk stumbled, fell to his knees, his vision blurring and the image of the smiling alien standing over Valkyrie being the last thing the Hulk saw. He fell. He breathed, so very slowly. The pain in his chest was gone, because he was gone. The Hulk was. Bruce Banner breathed again, seeing the bodies of dead Asgardians and Sakaaran gladiators strewn throughout the burning room. Then a large boot came crashing in front of his vision, a heavy palm falling on his back and pulling him off the ground. Banner lazily looked to the left, eyes widening in horror at the bloody face of the alien he had driven into a wall not too long ago. Cull Obsidian growled, turning to Midnight. With the Valkyrie beneath her foot, she planted her spear into the ground, smiling and hissing.
Father is waiting.
The great Titan thanks you for your sacrifice. Ebony Maw walked over the bodies. Do not fear what is to come, for in this cleansing you shall be remembered.
The bodies of the Asgardian warriors, the Sakaaran gladiators.
In this dark time, the pain will be great.
The Asgardian civilians.
The loss, even greater.
The men, women, and children.
But know that now and forevermore, you are all a part of the children of Thanos.
Pods lined the inside of the bridge and the statesmen. Within that bridge, complete and total carnage remained. Fires covered the debris that filled the bridge. Darkness was all that remained, the only form of light being the fires from the inside of the ship, and the fires that burned from the stars in space. The surprise attack was something the occupants could have never expected or fought against. Their bodies filled every inch of the bridge. Every last one of them fought back. The ones that survived the initial attack were silenced as Corvus Glaive searched through the slaughter, stabbing his glaive into the bodies that moved and breathed. He was very thorough. The Ebony Maw stared into his father, the mad Titan standing in silence, amongst the devastation and staring out into the vastness of space. Several footsteps appeared behind him, prompting Maw to spin about and face the siblings that approached. Proxima Midnight led Valkyrie forward, the sharpest end of her spear jabbing her in the back with every limp she took. Cull Obsidian carried the motionless body of Bruce Banner slung over his shoulder, his right hand gripping his bloody hammer, the other wrapped around the back of Korg's neck. Obsidian grunted towards Ebony Maw, tossing Korg ahead like the pile of rocks weighed nothing. Korg fell to his face, pressing his palms to the ground and slowly rising. The first thing he saw were the bodies surrounding him, the pools of blood stretching across the floor of the bridge. Korg looked around and saw nothing more than that. Just death. So many lives, so many young ones, just gone. He couldn't believe it. He tried not to. He blinked.
Meek? Where's Meek? What did you do to Meek? Did he wander off again, or probably roll off again? Lack of legs will do that to you.
Cull Obsidian slammed the butt of his hammer into the back of Korg's head.
Shut up! He roared, kicking Korg in the back and pushing the Cronin flat on his rocky chest.
Korg tried to get up, groaning as he did so, but Kull's large boot slammed down on him again, keeping him pinned to the floor of the ship. Korg barely lifted his head, turning left and seeing Loki hiding in the shadows. The god of mischief remained hidden behind a pile of the ship's debris, watching with bated breath, with horror in his eyes as Cull Obsidian dropped the body directly next to Korg. And Korg saw him. Saw Dr. Bruce Banner lie on the floor, barely breathing, his naked chest pressed to the bloody floor. Unlike Korg, there wasn't a boot pressed to his back. His fight was over. Banner had given in. The Hulk was gone. Their only good news was gone. A shrill scream followed, Valkyrie forced to her knees by the hands of Proxima Midnight. She snarled, quickly rising back to her feet, only to feel the strength of Midnight's fist collide with her cheek, forcing her back down on her knees. Valkyrie spat her own blood on the floor, adding to the pools, wiping her mouth and already rising up once again. She was stopped, and didn't move this time, as the blade on Proxima's spear was jutted her way, hanging very closely and very dangerously to her neck. Finally noticing the bodies of her people surrounding her, a single tear fell down her cheek, her red-rimmed eyes centered solely on the women behind her.
"You'll pay for this," Valkyrie said, her voice still shaking despite the strength she forced. "You all will."
Proxima Midnight only smirked. Lying amongst the bodies of his fallen warriors, Heimdall tried to reach for his blade, only to pause as a glaive was centered directly over his heart. He looked up, his orange irises landing on the growing smirk of Corvus' glaive. He expected to feel the glaive tear through his skin, pierce his heart, and end it all. The evil grin on the alien's face was certain of that, but he didn't push down. He waited.
"Thanos."
"Thanos, great titan, I present to you Loki Odinson."
Heimdall turned his bleeding forehead to the left, his eyes widening to see Loki being forced out of the shadows. As for Loki, an unnatural force he couldn't see nor sense gripped him, practically dragging him away from his cover and out into the open, directly in the center of the bridge and before the destroyed throne. The light of the stars beyond the glass window cast a shadow before him, a massive being standing where the throne of his brother once did. And all he could recall was that name. Thanos. Loki gulped, and remained frozen where he stood. Ebony Maw held no control over him. His head flicked upward, turning to the left. The light from the stars shone on his golden helmet. The Titan slowly spinning around until he faced the god of mischief in the flesh. Truly the flesh. No holograms. No tricks. Just him. Surrounded by death. The death of his own people, no less. All because of him. All because of what he had. Thanos smiled. Reaching down, he grabbed Thor's motionless form and dragged him forward.
"Oh, Loki," Thanos began, every syllable drawn out and so, so low. "You would go through so much deception, so much betrayal, so much pain and death, and still the endgame would be the same. You standing before me, a liar, a thief, a cheat, and a fool."
He came into full view. No longer any shadows hiding his face and the horrors that came with it. His eyes held a certain type of chaos that Loki wished he would never have to look upon again. They held what remained. What remained of the billions of lives that he snuffed out on his quest to rid the universe of its sickness, of its overpopulation. And in that chaos, those swirls of nothingness, Loki just stared. He tightened his jaw, and did everything in his power not to shiver. Blood coated his cheek, fresh cuts across his face and suit. When he offered no clever remark, Thanos stopped. He brought back his right palm, Thor's broken features brought into view. The God of Thunder gasped for air, blood pouring down his lips and painting the floor beneath him a dark crimson. He was even more torn up than Loki. Scratches and bruises across his face and blood coating his armor. He breathed steadily, his one good eye shifting to Loki. Loki stared back. Not a word. His eyes shifted back up to Thanos as he continued to speak.
I give you the power of an entire army. The choice to rule an entire planet the way you see fit. And all I ask in return is the scepter I give you. And the Tesseract, Thanos exclaimed.
He narrowed his gaze, his nostrils flaring.
Tell me, Loki, where are either?
Each of the Black Order turned their eyes away from the warriors they held, or the bodies they stared upon to turn Loki's way. And once more, he didn't even move. He hardly even breathed. The fires around him showed the fear on his face, the dread in his eyes. Loki knew it too, and finally found the courage to show some form of strength. He said,
The scepter is on Earth, and...
Pausing, he dropped his gaze, thinking for a moment. There wasn't much room to act, nor to cast illusions that Thanos wouldn't pick up on. No matter how much he hated to admit it, Loki had little to nothing left to hide.
I have the Tesseract.
Thor coughed blood, his eyes widening at that revelation. Shifting his attention quickly to Thor, and then back to Thanos, Loki finally managed to say,
I will give it to you in exchange for my release.
Loki!
Dropping his eyes to his brother once more, Loki watched as Thor became more distressed, just the thought of Loki abandoning them probably flooding his pain-filled mind at that very moment. Loki turned back to Thanos, his eyes trying to show bravery but still managing to fail.
Our release.
Thanos chuckled.
Still bargaining for his life,
he said, his smile fading as he centered his bemused expression on the adopted son of Odin.
Show it to me.
Loki's lips sealed shut, tightening into a thin line. He couldn't even look at Thanos, or Thor for that matter. For a second or two, he stood in silence, his body refusing to move despite what his intellect and instincts were telling him. The growls from Thanos' children behind him became more unsettling as the seconds ticked away, the remaining eyes of the room burning against him. So he did it. Lifting up his palm, and through a flush of golden energy, the Tesseract appeared in his hand. Thor's eye grew even larger. Thanos only further narrowed his own. Dropping the God of Thunder, Thanos reached upward and pulled off his helmet, dropping it like it meant nothing to him. He took a step forward, and with each step he removed a piece of his golden armor. Plating after plating fell off and rested amongst the body until all that remained was a gold and blue attire underneath, his sword on his back, black pants and boots, and the infinity gauntlet upon his left forearm and hand. He stopped feet in front of Loki and plucked the shimmering blue cube out of his hand. Staring at the Tesseract for a moment, Thanos proceeded to crush his right fist, cracks appearing over the surface of the cube, further and further until... A blast of whiteness nearly blinded everyone for a moment, but they quickly settled back into the darkness of the bridge. And in that darkness, Thanos opened his hand. The shards of the Tesseract remained, a shimmer of blue hidden in the crystals. Using his thumb to push the glowing blue light out of the crystals, Thanos gripped the light between his thumb and forefinger. Thor barely looked up, gritting his teeth at the sight of it. The Space Stone. One of the 6 Infinity Stones. Within the Tesseract all this time. To his horror, Thor watched as Thanos brought up his left arm, the golden gauntlet on his arm held outwards. He centered the stone directly over the glove, a flushing wave of blue energy building between the stone and the gauntlet the closer they grew. And then Thanos let go of the stone, to the indent directly beneath the gauntlet's forefinger. A wave of energy expelled from the golden plating. Thanos clenched his fist, sighing in content as he gazed at the glowing blue gem. The first of the 6. Now in his possession. And he smiled. Thanos smiled.
Fun isn't really something one considers when balancing the universe, he said, observing the space stone on his gauntlet.
It shimmered its might, glowing with raw intensity.
He chuckled. But this does put a smile on my face.
Yes, I assume it would, Loki said, causing Thanos' gaze to shift downwards to him. Now, about our bargain?
Thanos furrowed his brow. He grunted, nodding and stepping back. Turning around, Thanos reached down and grabbed Thor by his head this time, Loki's eyes widening at that. With Thor's head resting in his right palm, Thanos looked back to Loki, saw the desperation and growing worry in his eyes. He smiled again. Then he looked back to his Black Order.
Kill them, he said.
In an instant, Valkyrie's expression changed from fury to dread. Korg's eyes widened, Heimdall's mouth fell, hardly any breaths leaving him. Bruce Banner barely even moved, soft moans escaping his lips. He couldn't do much, but he did hear Thanos' order. The Black Order smiled, turning to their captives. Loki fared no better.
What?
He gasped, feeling his heart beat harder than it ever had before. The concept of death was nothing new to him. But here, with little room to act, and with every opportunity practically stripped away, his chances to slither out of his situation were as slim as could be. He shook his head, yelling and pointing to the Mad Titan.
No! We had a deal!
I'm just balancing everything out, Thanos replied, tightening his fingers around Thor's head, the God of Thunder cringing at the increasing pressure.
He didn't even look at the first son of Odin, just at Loki.
You betray my trust, I betray yours. Fitting. You lost the scepter. More importantly, the Mind Stone. Which reminds me.
He broke his contact from Loki, addressing his Black Order, when he said,
We're heading to Earth. Leave nothing.
On that order, Thanos pulled Thor's head upward, his body following. In an instant, he began to close his fist, his fingers tightening harder and harder around Thor's head. He screamed. The God of Thunder screamed in agony, his teeth covered in his own blood. He screamed so loud that Loki, no matter how hard he tried, couldn't get it out of his head, or out of his heart. The terror didn't stop there.
Wait, no! No!
Valkyrie cried out, attempting to stand and flee. In just one quick swipe, her neck was gushing red, both hands rising up to cover the blood and stop the pain. Valkyrie coughed out, tried to breathe, but failed at both, clutching onto her life. Proxima Midnight snickered behind her, kicking the last Valkyrie forward, where her body joined the rest of her Asgardian brothers and sisters.
No!
Heimdall bellowed, reaching for his discarded blade once more. He nearly reached it, his fingers on the grip, when he felt the sharpest end of the glaive pierce his heart. Heimdall stopped. Looking up one final time, he stared into the wild, hellish eyes of Corvus Glaive. The orange in his eyes slowly, so very slowly, faded away. The back of his head hit the ground.
Wait, can't we talk about...
Korg tried to say, only to be silenced for good as the head of Cull Obsidian's hammer came crashing down on his own head. Solid blue pebble shot out from the impact, Korg's hand rising slowly, before eventually falling to the floor, never to rise again. Cull Obsidian grunted, lifting up his hammer. And that left three. The sons of Odin. The last of Asgard. Them and Bruce Banner. Loki spun around, watching in horror as the ebony maw slowly approached him, malice held in his smile, evil glowing in his eyes. As one last-ditch effort to resist, Loki unsheathed a blade hidden under his cape, charging Maw and jamming the blade right for his throat. And just before the tip could pierce his esophagus, Loki was frozen. He gasped, looking to his arm, to the blade shaking in his hand, and finally to the Maw. He smiled, raising a single finger and shushing the God of Mischief. Loki could only watch as the blade was pulled by an unknown force from his own hand, and he could do nothing. He was forced to face his brother as he experienced his own demise at the hands of Thanos. Loki struggled against the force that held him down, feeling the maw grow closer, feeling the blade on his throat. He looked up to Thanos.
Wait. You don't want to do this. Maybe we can talk this through. Wait! All of his words were nothing to Thanos. He continued to crush his brother's head. Thor's screams echoing throughout the ship and punching Loki again and again. The blade on his throat grew closer and closer, the sharpest end tilting perfectly, aligning just right. Time was running out, and Loki desperately needed to think of something, anything to spare his own skin. Out of all of the tricks he had, there was but one left. One he thought he would never have to use. You don't want to go to Earth! And just like that, the madness stopped. Thanos stopped. When he did, the Black Order did. Staring onto their father with patience, waiting for his command and for what he wished. Was to further understand why the son of Odin spoke to him in such a way. He loosened his grip on Thor's head, but still held the god in place. Thor relaxed, but only so much. Blood dripped from his mouth, his eye barely opening to stare upon his brother. Not even looking at Loki, Thanos frowned.
And why is that? He asked.
Get him off me.
Thanos looked up. Ma, he said. Instantly, the blade fell from Loki's throat, the force around him vanishing into the air.
Loki straightened himself out, breathing steadily and looking up to the Mad Titan. He waited for Loki's response, his eyes slowly narrowing with each second Loki wasted just standing in shock.
Loki shook away that sensation that plagued him and answered,
I know of another world. A world ripe with magic even greater than Earth. Far greater than the Mind Stone.
At first, Thor couldn't understand what type of world would have magic greater than an Infinity Stone, or how Loki would have known about it. As moments passed, and Thor thought more on it, he thought back to years earlier, where Odin confronted him on the alien world, when the species there had faced their darkest hour, and Asgard rained down from the heavens to save them. When Odin confronted him on the alien world. No. When Loki confronted him on... Thor's eye widened with horror at the realization. He tried to stand up, to fight back, to do anything to stop Loki from dooming an entire planet.
Loki, no! He screamed. Those screams were silenced once Thanos tightened his fist, Thor falling back to his knees, cringing at the pain that Thanos applied to his head just by flexing his palm. Thanos frowned at the god whose life he held in his hand. Turning back to Loki, he watched as he gazed at his brother with what appeared to be sorrow, remorse, but strength nonetheless. Then he turned back to Thanos and said,
Let us go, and I will show you.
The idea of a planet holding greater power than an Infinity Stone was ludicrous. Thanos knew this to be true. He knew he should have crushed Thor's head and ended Loki for his deceit right then and there. He should have destroyed the ship he stood within and proceeded to Earth to acquire the next stone and take the next step closer to his ultimate destiny. He should have, but he didn't. Be it fate, be it destiny itself, but whatever it was that called out to him told him to wait. Listen to the Son of Odin, it said. Just one more time, it said. All will follow through. The power of this new world, the magic within it, was something he could not simply ignore. For when the time came of the cleansing, for the balancing of the universe, would this world survive? Would its magic protect it? Thanos would never know. Unless...
Fine, he said at last. Loki expelled a great breath of air. The relief clearly evident in his breathing. That breath was caught when Thanos finished. But in case this is another trick, he nodded to Ebony Maw.
Moving slowly in front of Loki, the Ebony Maw smiled. And when he spoke, his voice was smoother than the softest silk, more horrifying than any final cry Loki had ever heard. And worst of all, Loki felt his mind lose itself. His body failed to his command,
and his eyes gaze into the madness that remained within the maws. And he was lost in it. With its chilling voice, he asked but one question.
Now, where is this world?
Chapter 6. The Two Titans. Equus. Badlands, Equestria, 10:47 p.m. A tear in space opened in the heart of the Badlands. Through that mist of black and blue, Thanos and his Black Order stepped through and onto the new world. Instantly, the scenery was the first thing they saw. A complete and barren wasteland under the watchful gaze of the night sky and the alien moon's ghostly white light cascading across the desert. Sandstorms blocked the land in the distance, giving it a sense of endlessness. Mountaintops circled the landscape, hills and valleys stretching as far as the eye could see. And nearby, amongst the piles of rocks and boulders and dead plant life, remained the skeletal bodies of beasts long since extinguished. Their bones rose high, pearly white and cracked, as the Black Order walked past a particularly large one. Corvus Glaive reeled his nostrils back in disgust, just staring at the bones.
"This place reeks,"
Corvus Glaive gagged, stamping his glaive in the sand with each step he took.
"What's so special about this world?"
"I agree," Proxima Midnight added, staring at the far-off skeleton of a massive creature. "This place is dead." Cull Obsidian just grunted. Resting over his shoulder was Bruce Banner, still unmoving, still shirtless, and still groaning. Still alive. Instead of resting on his free shoulder, Thor was dragged by the back of his armor, eventually laid to rest when Thanos stopped just ahead of Obsidian. Thor was dropped chest-first into the dirt and sand, the God of Thunder gasping for air, coughing when he breathed in dust from the earth. The Ebony Moss stopped just by Thanos' side, and with him the God of Mischief, Loki Odinson, stood in silence. He stared in silence, at nothing. His eyes, as well as his brother's lone pupil, were dilated and glazed over. They could do nothing but wait and follow the orders that proceeded from Ebony Maw's whispers. But he ignored them, for the time being at least. Instead, he closed his own eyes, breathed in the air of the new world, and sighed. His fingers danced with one another, his thoughts processing, his very being taking in the energy of the world he stood upon, and the kind of magic it held. It was unlike anything he had ever experienced. It was not a dark magic coined by sorcerers with thoughts of only death and destruction on their mind. It was not a magic fueled by hatred, or of alchemy, or every possible consideration of how magic could be formed or birthed. The world he stood upon, of which he, his siblings, and his father remained, contained a magic that was harmonic. It was the perfect word to describe it. Harmony.
"Do you feel that, father?"
the Ebony Maw whispered. He breathed in several more times, exhaling with a sigh.
"That energy. That ripple of power. Oh, it's overwhelming."
"Guess Loki wasn't lying," Midnight said. Nodding to that, Ebony turned to the Mad Titan, staring at his backside.
"What say you, father?" Maw asked.
Thanos didn't respond at first. He was busy staring at the distant peaks, at the star-filled skies and the alien moon. But most importantly, he gazed at the tallest peak in the valley, the mountain that resided mere miles directly ahead of him. He stared at that mountain, at the devastation that surrounded, at the shattered boulders and dark crevice within it. He closed his eyes and felt the world. He felt the sand touch his skin as the air blew around him. He heard the cries of dead wind. He could smell the horrid stench of the wasteland. His fist clenched, the gauntlets plating, responding in kind.
"I know this world."
And just like that, the Black Order turned their attention to Thanos. Thor tried to push himself up, but Cull Obsidian planted his boot on his back, keeping him down.
"I've seen it before.
In my dreams, Thanos muttered. He bent down, and with his right hand grazed the sand beneath him. He felt the particles between his fingers, bringing his hand close and watching as the dust faded away into the air. In his expression, his eyes, he felt only emptiness.
I was meant to come here.
Why? Glaive asked, breaking the silence that Thanos was trapped in. He ignored Glaive's question. Standing back up, Thanos stared at the gauntlet, at the space stone for several seconds. The gem shimmered a dark blue, its center lighter than the rest of its being. Thanos clenched the gauntlet tight, looking back to the tallest peak in the center of the wasteland. He felt a strange chill race across his violet skin. The first time in a long time.
What is this world?
He said, asking no one. He turned around when the maw started moaning. He had his eyes closed, his hands held low, fingers outstretched to point to the earth beneath him.
Oh. Oh, it's so beautiful. This magic, this harmony. I sense it far away. The strongest on this world.
Ebony Maw paused, opened his eyes.
And yet, something is blocking it. Blocking me. Something's coming.
What's coming? Proxima Midnight asked, her body tensing up. Ebony Maw blinked, breathed, and said,
Something darker.
As the deathly silence of the night crept back in, it was drowned away as the ground erupted and the earthquake followed through. The Black Order stumbled to keep themselves steady. Loki nearly fell, but straightened himself out and turned his attention forward, towards Thanos. Towards the darkest form of energy he had ever felt pulse across his skin and throughout his body. Thanos felt it too, but it was far from being the darkest energy he had ever felt. Still, he kept his balance as the tremor continued its onslaught, keeping his eyes latched with ground, jaw tightening and teeth clenching. And then, it came.
Thanos!
The voice. Followed shortly by the earth erupting several yards in front of them. The Black Order proceeded to back away, weapons at the ready. The ones that stayed where they were happened to be Cull Obsidian, having to keep his foot planted on Thor. And Thanos. The others took several precautionary steps back as they observed what spewed from the earth. Thanos observed it as well, and he frowned. It erupted from the ground as a stream of fire. A massive stream of fire. Just the width of it was larger than the ground all four members of the Black Order and Thanos covered. On closer inspection, they noticed the fire to be a form. A single pillar of bright burning orange and blood red. That pillar of fire bent at an angle, moved about that fire wouldn't normally have done. In fact, Thanos noticed how the fire seemed to move, as a serpent would. His theory seemed to be true, as the face of the fire finally came into view, staring down from its elevated position high above the earth, and it stared at them. Its face was pointed, much like a serpent. Several jagged horns remained atop its head. But its eyes were the worst, glowing a bright red, even brighter than the fires that consumed its entire form. The beast, the serpent, whatever it was, stared down at the Black Order. More importantly, it stared at Thanos. Even more important, it knew its name. Meaning that the wrath of Thanos was spread throughout most of the known universe, just as he wanted. Thanos narrowed his eyes on the beast. The beast did the same towards the Mad Titan, and for several seconds, that was their situation. Until Ebony Maw somehow found the strength to step forward, closer towards the creature. After several seconds of nothing, he assumed it wasn't going to attack them. At least, not yet. For the time being, he would get a closer look.
Well,
This is certainly an interesting development, Ebony Maw said, growing closer and closer to the flaming serpent. He was stopped by Thanos, who held up his right hand to him and spoke out.
Who are you?
The beast exhaled through its nostrils. It slowly leaned downwards, closer towards the mad titan and his children. Thanos could feel the heat increasing, his gauntlet clenching, the stone shimmering, just in case they needed an escape. The creature studied them, its burning gaze narrowing for a second, then relaxing. When it spoke, its mouth would not move. It was as if the voice was carried out throughout its entire existence, essence. That essence, that unhinged darkness and energy made even the maw tingle in his knees. Thanos could feel the same flushing throughout his veins. It was a darkness they had never encountered, an evil they had yet to experience, and it said,
My name.
The beast paused, almost appearing to be lost in thought. Turning its head back to Thanos, the creature finished, expelling a torrent of flames from its nostrils.
I am Typhon.
The beast, known as Typhon, lowered its head even further. Thanos could feel the heat on his skin, but he would not back away like his children had.
You dare step upon my world, Mad Titan?
Typhon growled. The fires were so bright on its skin, even brighter in its eyes, that Thanos couldn't stare into for long, no matter how much he wanted to intimidate the beast. It was like staring into the heart of a newborn star, keeping his gaze locked with the beast's mouth instead. Thanos said,
If it be a step closer to destiny, then I suppose I have.
Typhon snorted, flames shooting out from its being.
What do you want from Equus?
Equus, Thanos said, tasting the name on his tongue. So that's the name of this world. I had a feeling. First the dreams, then... It would seem fate itself wants me here.
Typhon narrowed his eyes, the glowing slits burning with raw, red energy.
Then fate is wrong.
Raising a brow at that, Thanos flared his own nostrils, mirroring the beast that called Typhon. The Black Order stood with its weapons at the ready, pointing them to Typhon, leaning back and preparing themselves after the beast's tone shifted dangerously low. Studying their positions, looking back at Thanos, Typhon snarled, leaning back several yards.
Whatever you plan, I will ensure that you will not bring about the destruction of the world that is rightfully mine. Not until the princesses and the pillars pay for what they have done to me.
Princesses, Thanos repeated.
Pillars, Proxima Midnight whispered to her husband. Corvus Glaive just stared at her, baring his teeth, just as confused as her. They both turned back to the fire, flinching as Typhon roared.
Enough of this!
Typhon bellowed, rearing back his neck.
The fate of the universe hangs in the balance by a simple thread. Trillions of lives vanquished in an instant. Entire worlds crumbling, collapsing. My own following. I will not allow you to leave here to continue on that path of universal devastation.
And as he said those words, that deadly final threat, several eruptions surrounded the Black Order and Thanos. Thor and Loki could do nothing but watch. Watch as several burning red tendrils shot out from the dirt, just as equally massive as the serpent's head that glared down at them from above. But instead of holding facial features like Typhon, the tendrils were as sharp as blades, pointed ends turned towards Thanos and his children, poised to kill.
Stand ready!
Glaive yelled, weapon jutted outwards from his hands. Thanos turned about, staring at the tendrils that surrounded him. Instantly, he shot out his hand, the Infinity Gauntlet and the Space Stone reacting to his will.
The stone shimmered, its energy coursing through the air and attaching to Typhon's body, then to the tendrils, then completely fading from existence. Thanos bellowed, bringing back his gauntlet and staring at the stone in shock. Whatever it was, whatever Typhon was, he was invulnerable to it. It did nothing.
That's not possible,
Thanos breathed, turning his eyes back to the beast snarling from above. He didn't react in time to the smaller tendril shooting out from the ground beneath his feet. They latched onto his arms, wrapping around Thanos' gauntlet so tight he couldn't even move his fingers. Nor could he close his fist. Thanos bared his teeth, looking back to see the same thing befall his children. The tendrils wrapped around the arms and legs of each of the Black Order, keeping them frozen in place, unable to escape no matter how hard they struggled.
So weak,
Typhon taunted, the tendrils hovering higher and rearing back, ready to strike. Typhon's gaze and tendrils constricted ever so tighter, concentrating solely and only on Thanos. And he was disappointed.
You shouldn't have never come to Equus.
By that, the tendril shot down, halting once Thanos raised his head and yelled, Wait! The tendrils stopped, mere yards above their heads. The Black Order slowly twisted their heads back to their father, limbs still held down from their flaming tendrils. They spotted Typhon above, glaring at them from below. Fire practically melted from his face and eyes, dripping down and dying in the sand. Burning ash evaporated from its being. And even so, Typhon waited.
I don't want this world.
Typhon leaned in closer, until his gargantuan face was mere feet from Thanos' own. He glared down at the mad titan with a forever cinder boiling in his eyes, narrowing the slits until each eye glowed even brighter. He stared into Thanos' eyes, searching for the deceit, but finding none. He growled, finally releasing the mad titan and his children. The fiery tendril slid back into the dirt, the Black Order rubbing their limbs. Thanos clenched his gauntlet.
I want balance, Thanos continued, shielding his eyes from the brightness with his right palm. For in this vast universe, there is a constant sickness, a lone cancer that cannot be cleansed, unless one was willing to do so. To gather the power needed to do so. If I can, and I will, this universe will be free from overpopulation. And you, Typhon, will have this world. And so much more.
Typhon backed away a few feet, Thanos lowering his arm to rest by his side. He said,
You just need to trust me.
The beast leaned further back, eyes widening in that statement.
Trust you?
Typhon laughed. His laughter faded shortly, replaced with a soft growl that only intensified as the constant seconds of pain and torment powered on. He screamed.
The last time I trusted someone, my children were slaughtered.
It was at that did Thanos actually flinch in surprise. How such a beast, an uncaring and vile monster, could actually have children that he cared for, that he loved, and he lost, was sounding more and more familiar the longer he thought about it. Thanos stared at the gauntlet, at the stone and the empty spaces with it, and closed his eyes. It was because of his lust for saving the universe, his constant drive to acquire the stones, that he sent away his favorite daughter to find one in particular. And she left him. Never returned. Joined a group of freaks and called herself a hero. Thanos opened his eyes and saw the world. He saw Typhon, and Typhon saw the world staring off into the distance of the dead and barren landscape.
What happened here? Thanos asked.
And for just a second, a fleeting moment, he sounded sincere. And, for just a moment, a brief millisecond that would never come to pass again, Typhon actually appeared saddened. The fires on his body began to cool, began to dim down,
but still held a great amount of strength. Not one of fury, but from within. From his deeper, more personal power. From the heart that hadn't beaten over 1,000 years. And he spoke. His voice was not one of anger like it had been before. It was calm.
The land you look upon was once a thriving landscape, where I ruled with my children. We were a strong race, a proud one. But this land could not hold us and our growing family. We needed to expand.
Typhon turned away from the hills covered in sandstorms, his gaze falling at before Thanos' feet.
The princesses and the pillars thought otherwise.
He growled softly, continuing. The Black Order began to lower their weapons, listening. Loki, Thor, and even Bruce Banner stared at the flaming beast, remaining silent.
They turned against me. Turned the whole world against me and my children. Our home became a barren wasteland in the aftermath. And with a magic far greater than I could have fought against, the rulers of this world struck me down, banished me beneath the earth, and proceeded to do the same with my children.
Typhon slowly closed his eyes, the brightest lights dying out.
Every last one of them.
Thanos could feel his eyes start to burn. It wasn't because of the fires.
Until we were all prisoners of Tartarus. We were tortured constantly, endlessly for more than 1,000 years. Until I was nothing more than a spirit. A soul of my former self. I thought I could fight back. Deliver that one last final blow to the rulers of this wretched world. When Ultron came to me.
The name, Ultron, caught Thanos for a moment, but he remained silent, allowing Typhon to continue.
But he as well. Let my children die. Until I was but the last of my kind.
Thanos' head perked up even higher at that statement alone. Typhon's eyes stared into the ground, a grieving look appearing in the twin flames.
And so, I waited, in hiding, within the shadows and always watching, never fighting, but growing stronger, every single day, until the day would come where I would enact my vengeance on this world, and the rulers of it, for taking everything from me!
The fires returned just as bright as before, if not even brighter, having to rekindle old, painful memories. Typhon's eyes lit up like a burning furnace, centering down on Thanos alone. His children held out their weapons once more, returning their attention to the tendrils zeroing in and the massive head closing down on them.
And I will not allow you to wipe out half of this world away before I do so.
Then I won't. Typhon's head backed away, his neck leaning several yards backwards, eyes slowly widening. Turning away from the tendril she faced, noticing how it too began to slither backwards, Proxima Midnight looked at her father. "What?" Midnight blurted out. "Father," Ebony Maw began, his tone sounding betrayed. The Black Order were silenced in the instant Thanos raised his gauntlet. To silence them. To trust him.
"We share some things in common," Thanos said, staring right into the eyes of the beast.
It didn't hurt this time. The fire in his eyes had cooled considerably. They cooled even further with Thanos' next words.
"You are the last of your race, and I am the last of mine. Your home was destroyed, and so was mine. Despite our most desperate acts to stop its collapse, and you only want to give your children a better life."
Thanos' gaze was elsewhere for a moment. Tightening his fists, Thanos continued.
I see what you want. Justice done right. And I can give you that. I can give you your form again. Your strength again. Your life again. This world can be yours. Again.
Somewhat startled by his offering, Typhon nonetheless growled, leaning closer.
And how do you propose to do that?
He asked. Thanos thought for an instant, then turned towards the gauntlet. The space stone continued to glow calmly against it, its power rippling off of it in unseen waves. Thanos slowly lifted his gauntlet to Typhon, who studied the weapon and the stone. Thanos then said,
I'll need one more stone. With it, you'll have the power to finally be reborn.
He lowered the gauntlet after that compromise, and Typhon was silent. As if the world-breaking, race-killing, mad titan Thanos was willing to offer him something as insane as it was even more insane for Typhon to listen. If what he said was true, what with them sharing similar things in common, then how far could Typhon truly trust the mad titan to live up to his end of the bargain? He could slaughter them right there, burn their corpses, and fling their bones to the Badlands, and the universe would be saved. And no one would know Typhon saved it. They would only know if he lived again. If what Thanos said was true, he could live again. If what he said was true... Typhon leaned in once more, much closer than he had before, and stared the mad titan in the eyes. Thanos did the same, titan to titan. He didn't look away. Neither did.
Swear to me!
Thanos' brow wrinkled.
Swear to me, when you bring me that power, that Equus, the princesses, and the pillars are mine.
To Typhon's relief, Thanos smiled and raised his right hand.
When I get what I need, when I snap my fingers, he did just that, Equus, and all with it, will still exist.
The fire was extinguished. The tendrils fell back into the ground, and Typhon retreated back into the earth. The silence of the night slowly, very slowly, followed through. The winds of the Badlands surrounded Thanos and his Black Order. They stumbled about, weapons lowered, wondering whether or not what they just experienced was real or a dream. Thanos knew it to be true. He knew that the proposal he made to save their lives cost them a planet that would be spared for the cleansing. But in the end, would one world truly matter in the grand scheme? It would not, Thanos thought. This world didn't belong to him. It belonged to someone more deserving. Someone with retribution to fulfill. But still, that didn't mean Equus wouldn't experience salvation beforehand. But before that, Thanos thought back to his own proposal. To the power he promised Typhon in exchange for their lives. The power he promised. Power. Looking back to Proxima Midnight, Thanos slowly smiled.
Midnight. As you were saying about Xandar?
Chapter 7. Calling All Guardians. Andromeda Galaxy. Xandar. Nova Empire. A Chitauri Leviathan tore through a Xandarian superstructure, spewing building debris across the landscape and the terrifying Xandarian populace below. The multitude of races scattered in fear as the Leviathan roared over their heads. These races, ranging from across the entire galaxy, of which the planet protected by the Nova Corps was known for, could do nothing as hell and fire rained down from above. The sky was blotted out, the three suns shielded by the clouds and the Chitauri warships that descended upon the helpless Nova Empire. The brave Nova Corps did all they could, rallying every able-bodied soldier they could take to the skies and bring down the invading force. But it was all for naught. They came without warning. without remorse, and they intended to leave nothing. Chitauri chariots, leviathans, and starships took to the air, wiping out any Nova craft that stayed in the skies, trying desperately to hold off the alien forces invading their home. The flaming husks of Nova star blasters rained down from the sky, crashing into buildings, hitting markets filled with innocent civilians, and killing even more as they impacted the ground. Xandarians screamed and fled, knowing not where to go in the madness. As for Roman Day, Denarian rank of the Nova Corps, he knew exactly where he was going, straight home to his wife and daughter, and getting as far away from the fight as possible. The madness and chaos only worsened as the Chitauri grew closer and closer to the Nova Corps headquarters. Raman could see the warfare continue as he ran past several windows lining the walls of the complex. Several Nova Corps ran in his direction, toward the hangar bay to acquire a star blaster and join the fight for their survival. And Raman would do the very same, as soon as his family was safe. He had caught word that the Chitauri had warships over every major district in the Nova Empire, including the one holding his wife and daughter. They needed to be safe. He couldn't continue the fight unless he knew they were safe. Raman Day ran as fast as he could, and didn't stop, even as the Nova Empire crumbled around him. Throughout his dead sprint through the headquarters, Day was constantly thinking of why exactly were the Chitauri attacking Xandar? Why now? All he could deduce was that the Chitauri were on Xandar, laying waste to the city and heading towards the heart of the Nova Empire. There was only one being in the entire universe who controlled the mighty fleet of the Chitauri army. Thanos. And he was coming for them. Raman Day was too old for gunfights, but his piloting skills were nothing short of incredible. Once he acquired a star blaster, he could fly over to his wife and daughter, get them to a safe house he knew of, then get back into the fight and aid his Nova brothers and sisters in the sky. Until the bitter end, if need be. It was a plan he had set on his mind throughout his entire sprint to the hangar bay. A plan that would have to be put on hold as his communicator screamed. Slowing to a halt just by the control center, and managing to catch his breath in the meantime, Day activated the communicator on his wrist, gasping,
"This is Denarian Nova Corps Raman Day speaking. What's going on down there, Nova Prime?"
Nova Prime, Irene Ryle, responded quickly, her voice muffled by the static.
"Day, I need word on the invasion above ground. Are you near the control room?"
Turning to his left, Raman Day stepped into the control room, activating the hologram displaying the entire empire before him. He lifted his wrist.
"I got you covered, Nova Prime. What do you need to see?"
As Nova Corps ran right on behind him, completely ignoring Day and proceeding to the hangar bay, Nova Prime asked,
"Where are the Chitauri headed?"
Day tapped away at his hologram, bringing images of the warships in the sky closer for inspection. As expected, as he could see from the large window surrounding the control center, the warships were headed straight for the headquarters. Day shook his head, saying,
"I got bad news, Prime. The Chitauri are heading right for us. They're..."
Then suddenly, the warships halted, then began to rise. Higher and higher. Even the Chitauri leviathans and starships began to retreat from the surface of the planet. Raman couldn't believe it. Not at first. Then quickly swiped away with both hands on the hologram, observing the entire Nova Empire. Through every district, the warships retreated and fled to the upper atmosphere. Day almost smiled, relief flooding his heart. Just the thought of his wife and daughter still safe kept his mind at ease. He said,
"Scratch that, Prime. Looks like the Chitauri are retreating from the fight.
The only question is..." Nova Prime didn't respond. Not for several seconds. Then, without warning, the screams erupted from his communicator. But Raman Day wasn't paying attention to that. At least not at first. The entire Nova Corps headquarters trembled as if an earthquake was ripping the Earth in two directly beneath it. It was followed by an explosion so deafening that Raman felt his bones shake, from his feet to his skull. Holding on to the base of where the hologram originated, Raman brought up his wrist and asked,
"Prime, what happened? Are you all okay down there?"
The screams came back, but he could make them out this time, and they screamed,
"He's here! Thanos is here!"
Day's eyes grew so massive they nearly popped out of his skull. Then Nova Prime called to him, said to him, "Ramen, Thanos is coming for the orb. We're doing our best to hold him off, but it won't be enough. If he gets his hands on that orb, then Xandar is gone," Ramen yelled, gripping even tighter onto the base of the hologram. The fear of his family's safety quickly crept back into his heart once the realization came to him. If Thanos got the orb, and more importantly, the Power Stone, he could wipe out all of Xandar in seconds. Seconds. Day did not have that kind of time. Not enough time to save his family. He needed to leave. Now. Until Nova Prime screamed, "We need you to contact the Guardians of the Galaxy!" Ramen Day was already by the exit of the control center when she said that. He stopped. "We are out of options, Ramen! Thanos is getting nearer! Send a distress signal to the Guardians right this instant!" Ramen stared at the empty hallway. If he wasn't the last one out of the headquarters before, then he surely was now. Through the glass windows, he could see the fires raging across every district, the Chitauri fleeing from the planet's surface. "That is an order!" He could see his district straight ahead, and even though he was miles and miles away, he could have sworn he saw his home, his wife, his daughter. How terrified they were, wondering where Ramen was, where Daddy was. He tightened his fists, slowly looking back to the control center console, where the hologram of the burning empire still shimmered. Through his communicator, he heard an explosion.
"Shit! He's here! Open fire!"
Then nothing but blaster fire and screams. Then static. Then nothing. There was no one else in the control center but him. Everyone had already fled the empire or joined in on the fight that wasn't there anymore. They would never know that Thanos was there, nearing the Power Stone, and ready to end everything. Not unless someone told them what to do. Rushing back to the control center console, he deactivated the hologram and flipped a switch, then pressed down on the big golden button on the console with his thumb. He spoke into the console with the clearest voice he could, and he could even hear his own voice echo throughout the cities around him. It's who he addressed, after all. Every city, every district, and every Nova Corps member. "This is Denarian Nova Corps Ramen Day on all frequencies. The war is lost. The orb is in the hands of our enemy. All Nova Corps members proceed with complete evacuation of the planet. Ready the arcs and get as many Xandarians off the planet as fast as you can." He flipped another switch, turned a nozzle, and pressed his thumb down on the big red button on the console. The one they only use for emergencies at levels they haven't seen since the Battle of Xandar 4 years ago. Back when the Guardians of the Galaxy saved their entire planet. With sweat streaming from his forehead, his heart pounding with fear and adrenaline, Ramen Day quickly said, "This is the Nova Corps sending a distress signal to the Guardians of the Galaxy. If you can hear us, if you can get this message in time, then please hurry. Xandar is under attack. We are out of options. I repeat, please hurry." He sent the distress signal, then took off as fast as he could to the hangar bay. The rest was practically a blur to him. His star blaster was the only one left in the entire hangar bay. He sprinted, never stopping, his sides crying out in pain and his heart working harder than it ever had in years. But he didn't care. His communicator received nothing, and he could only fear the worst. He could only pray that Nova Prime and her soldiers could hold Thanos off for just a moment longer. Just a moment longer. By the time he fled the hangar bay and took flight, Ramen Day was propelling himself through the carnage the Chitauri left, completely ignoring the rest of his Nova Corps brothers and sisters as they fled to the districts, the massive Nova arcs rising from beneath the seas. They fled to get the civilians to the arcs. They fled to save their families. But Ramen Day saw them. He saw their sacrifice and pressed his forearm across his heart. It was only a matter of time. Just a moment longer. Ramen Day saw his home approaching closer by the second. He punched it, his star blaster jetting even faster. Day steadied himself as he drew nearer, needing to fly in for a safe landing, safe enough not to damage the ship so his family could get off the planet. It was a race against time, a race against life and death itself. His home was getting closer. Day bit his lip, sweat blinding him for a moment. Just a moment longer. He made it. He saw his home draw near, his wife and daughter waiting for him. He couldn't see them, but he could feel them in his heart. He never let that adrenaline die, slowing his star blaster down for a smooth landing on his home's landing pad. Then it happened. The sky erupted into a bright, brilliant violet. Ramen Day's star blaster was nearly blown out of the sky, but he quickly regained control, spinning his head around and seeing it. The Nova Corps headquarters was gone. It was gone, replaced only with a tower of dark purple. And it quickly spread, faster than he could have anticipated. A violent and hellish wave of purple washed over the Nova Empire, completely dissolving the arcs and the districts near them. The very earth beneath the cities erupted, as if 1,000 volcanoes had gone off at once, spewing its purple volcanic rock into the violet-painted skylines. Nova star blasters were blown out of the sky instantly as the wave washed over them, evaporating into nothing. And that wave approached him, faster and faster. Gritting his teeth and yanking down on his ship's steering wheel, he violently pulled it downward, putting everything he could into the overdrive. His star blaster cried out, rocketing straight towards the sky and never stopping. He could barely move as the increased speed forced him back into his seat, but he managed to look back. Just once, and he saw it. He wished he hadn't. His city, his district, his home, was washed away instantly, vaporized in a violet light. But he wasn't. He kept flying and flying, faster and faster, until he no longer saw the purple skies and burning air, until he saw nothing but the blackness of space. His star blaster sputtered and died, the weightlessness of space following. And Ramen Day drifted, he and his star blaster, through space, safe and sound. He breathed. He lived. He stared back at his burning world. Nothing survived. Absolutely nothing. The entire surface was quickly consumed in a hellish purple, streaks of blackness stretching from the Nova Empire and throughout the rest of the world. And Ramen Day just watched as his home burned away, as his family became just another number. A single tear fell from his eye. Fell from the eye of the last Nova Corps. His eyes shimmered a bright purple as Xandar exploded. The Power Stone shimmered a bright purple as Xandar exploded. Thanos clenched his fist, clenched the Infinity Gauntlet and brought it forward, letting it rest near his smile. He and his children watched as chunks of the planet slowly drifted apart, the core of Xandar burning a brilliant violet before slowly, slowly dimming into nothing. Just nothing. Thanos looked to the gauntlet, to the second Infinity Stone he placed beneath the middle finger, the Power Stone. Truly and utterly brilliant, its magnitude and strength unmatched by any other, except the remaining stones, that is. He smiled to it, his gaze then shifting to the three standing before him, watching as the remains of Xandar burned away. Loki, Thor, and Banner. Loki stood as frozen stiff as he could manage, his eyes still glazed over, but with a purple shimmer glowing in his irises as the planet's remains burned into non-existence. Thor was hardly standing, gripping his abdomen in pain, palm pressed to the glass in front of him, glazed eye watching the chaos unfold. Banner remained on his knees, clutching the healing wound over his heart and watching with complete and utter horror in his eyes. His eyes that were completely clean, no glaze, no control. He saw and experienced everything. Maw. Bruce Banner slowly spun his head around, shaking as he did so, watching as the ebony Maw crept over to them by command of the Titan Thanos. Bruce watched, fear gripping his healing heart as the Maw smiled and whispered, "Return." Both Thor and Loki's eyes returned to normal, the glaze vanishing. Loki and Thor both gasped as if they had been drowning and had only now come up to the real world. And the first thing they saw were the devastated remains of an entire planet drift away. Thor pressed both of his palms onto the glass, his only widening in horror. Loki just trembled, spinning about as he heard that laughter. That horrible chuckle he knew all too well. Thor spun around as well. Thanos smiled at them, his eyes holding nothing but malicious intent. In his gauntlet, the three of them could see a second shimmer of light. A second Infinity Stone. Thor's mouth fell, not a breath leaving him. Looking to his gauntlet, then to one of the trio, Thanos said,
"You've done very well, Loki. So unlike you."
Loki said nothing. Neither did Thor. He stood and clenched his fists, electricity sparking across his knuckles. Bruce Banner just trembled. Thanos crushed his gauntlet into a fist.
"And so, unlike you, I'll keep my end of our bargain. You give me the world you promised, and in return, I let you go. All of you, go."
He chuckled, the space stone shimmering.
"Should have specified where."
A vicious portal of blue and black appeared directly in front of them. Just as viciously, the portal was thrust their way, faster than the trio could react, faster than they could move to get away, and faster than they could even let out a scream. And even in the vastness of space, when they did scream, no one heard them.
This is the Nova Corps sending a distress signal to the Guardians of the Galaxy. If you can hear us, if you can get this message in time, then please hurry. Xandar is under attack. We are out of options. I repeat, please hurry!
Shit, Rocket Raccoon cursed, watching Star-Lord silence the distress call by pressing a single button on the console in front of him. Both he and Rocket sat side by side, the pilots of the Milano spacecraft, two of the six Guardians of the Galaxy that piloted their ship through the wormhole and towards the source of the distress call. It was just an average day for the Guardians of the Galaxy, flying by a few cluster of planets, listening to Quill, Zune, and rocking out to the songs they've never heard before in their lives, save for Quill, of course. Then, completely out of the blue, their communicator started to go crazy. It wasn't just any communicator. It was one specially included with the Milano after they had saved Xandar a few years back. It was a direct line to the Nova Corps, for whenever they needed to contact the Nova Corps, or when the Nova Corps needed to call the Guardians. In this case, they desperately needed the Guardians. Good timing, too. They were running out of units and needed the cash. It had been a while since their last job. Tapping away along with Quill, Rocket kept the Milano in stable position as they soared through the wormhole, growing nearer to Xandar's location. Rocket thought back to the distress call, smirking and chuckling a tad. Might as well break the awkward tension with some good old-fashioned heckling. "And I thought Quill cried worse in his sleep." Peter Quill, Star-Lord, suddenly turned to the raccoon on his left. With accusing eyes, he declared, "You don't know that." Rocket smiled, keeping his claws on the handles that helped steer the Milano. "Oh, but Gamora does," he said. "What are you insinuating?" Gamora asked from one of the front seats beneath where Peter and Rocket sat. Her black and fiery red hair spun as she shifted her heated gaze to the raccoon, her green skin wrinkling as she narrowed her eyes at him. Rocket turned his head down to meet her gaze. He pointed a claw her way in an accusing manner. "Hey, what did we say about using words we don't know the meaning of?" Rocket asked, suddenly turning the focus to Gamora. "You know that hurts Drax's brain."
"Yeah,"
Drax declared, spinning his neck left from his seat directly beneath Quill. He settled back into his previous position, mumbling,
"I hate words that don't come from me."
"Back to what Gamora was talking about," Peter interrupted, keeping his eyes on the wormhole ahead. "We are not, you know, that intimate yet." "Why doesn't she sleep in her own room, then?" Rocket asked. "Because she has nightmares," Peter said, as if it was the most obvious thing in the world. "I thought we established this." "Quill, you have nightmares," Gamora deadpanned. Peter held out his hand. "We both have nightmares. Sometimes, mostly me. The point is that we keep each other company. Nothing more than that.
I am Groot.
Whoa, slow down, Peter yelled. Gamora's jaw fell, turning her disgusted eyes to Groot in the back seat. The adolescent Groot leaned on one of the seat's armrests. His stumps for legs lazily lay over the opposite armrest, slowly swinging back and forth. As for his attention, the majority of it was focused on the handheld video game he was enamored with. The name Arcade Defender was plastered on the video game's face, the adolescent Groot's eyes glued to the bright screen. That is, until he caught everyone's attention with his rather vulgar sense of humor. At least someone found it funny. Rocket laughed out loud.
Hell yeah, Groot, you sick bastard.
Pay attention, Rocket. And you, Groot, zip it. And watch your language, Peter scolded, turning his heated stare back to Groot, who only raised a brow and shrugged before returning to his game. Peter shook his head, focusing ahead.
Teenagers, Jesus.
We need to focus, Mantis said loudly, her seat directly behind Quill's and right to Groot's. She closed her eyes, her antenna glowing softly.
We are nearing Xandar. I can feel it.
Yeah, when Bug Eyes is telling us to focus, you know something is wrong,
Rocket muttered. Mantis heard him, giggling at the name he gave her. Groot smirked in his seat, returning to his handheld video game. He nearly reached his high score, tapping away furiously on the screen. As the rowdiness within the Milano simmered down, Peter Quill assumed his command of the ship once again. And at that moment, he became the Star-Lord once more. Super serious, badass space nomad and fearless leader of the Guardians of the Galaxy. We're approaching the end of the jump. Hold steady, Star-Lord addressed to them. The Milano slowed down as the wormhole neared its end, and as they exited the jump, their eyes lit up in shock and awe. The Guardians of the Galaxy paid witness to a massive warship come into focus, and then instantly vanish as it jumped to some unknown destination, trails of cosmic dust being all that remained where it once was. They never got a good enough look at it. Choosing to focus instead on Xandar, Star-Lord said, All right, Guardians, don't forget, this might be dangerous, so let's put on our mean faces. Mantis tried to, but only ended up puffing out her lower lip and frowning. That expression slowly faded away, as did everyone else's, when Xandar finally came into focus. Those mean faces that Quill wanted never came to be. All that was left on each Guardian's face was confusion and horror.
What the hell?
Rocket whispered, leaning forward in his chair. Swirls of space dust colored a sickly dark purple remained, slithering across massive chunks of debris, surrounded only by billions upon billions of asteroids filling the void where Xandar once remained. At its core, Xandar had vanished, and the core of the planet itself was extinguished. Shades of a hideous purple was all that glowed across the debris, eventually fading away into nothing but a dark, dead slab of rock that once harbored life. Gamora, nearly breathless, said,
It's Xandar.
What's left of it? Peter said, eyes gazing to the chunks of the planet beyond the glass and above his head. Mantis's large eyes reflected the burning purples from the planet's debris. An eerie silence followed, encircling the Guardians and trapping them within it.
What happened? Mantis asked.
Groot slowly looked up from his video game, his eyes glistening from the violet flames of the planet's surfaces.
I am Groot,
he said, astonishment in his voice. He lost his last life in his game, but even Groot didn't seem to care at the moment. Each of the Guardians were so awestruck by the remains of the planet Xandar, and the Nova Empire as a whole, that they didn't even notice the three bodies hurtling their way until it was too late. They impacted the glass shield of the Milano, causing every Guardian to nearly leap out of their seat. Rocket observed the bodies, waving his claw out in front of him.
Ew! Wipers! Wipers! Get them off!
Hold up, Star-Lord ordered, peeking closer at the bodies that hit their glass shield. One was heavily built, short hair, and an eye patch covering his right eye. He was absolutely filthy, bloodstains across his beard and body. The second one was much skinnier, wearing what appeared to be a cape of some kind. His long black hair and pale white skin were splotched with dark crimson. The third one was shirtless, scrawny, and barely hanging on to life. Peter Quill needed to know for sure.
He leaned forward in his seat, narrowing his eyes at the trio they hit. Their bodies don't look frozen over. They may still be alive, he observed. The largest one opened his eye. Mantis screamed. Quill fell back in his chair, saying loudly, "Or they are still alive!" "Let's go, Quill!" Gamora said, already up and out of her seat, racing towards the holographic spacesuits and the exit of the Milano. Quill wasn't far behind her. "Right," he said, hopping out of his seat. "What did we agree on about not taking in hitchhikers?" Rocket asked, looking back towards Quill and Gamora. He noticed that Mantis went with them, only Groot remaining in his seat playing with his game. Drax was there, too, beneath Quill's chair, but he was fast asleep, drooling onto his shoulder. "Does no one listen to me anymore?" Rocket exclaimed. "I am Groot." "Oh, screw you too, you medium-sized asshole," Rocket said, hopping out of his seat and rushing to join Quill and the others. Groot just smirked at his furry backside, returning to his video game and completely ignoring the three splattered on their windshield. Power. Milky Way Galaxy, Equus, Badlands Equestria, 11:39 p.m. The second Thanos stepped foot on Equestrian soil, a tremor resounded across the Valley of Death, in the heart of the Badlands. A vicious black and blue portal opened for Thanos and his Black Order, all five exiting the swirling blue and black mist as it quickly faded away. The space stone on Thanos' gauntlet dimmed down as the portal closed, but it never stopped shimmering, as well as the newly acquired Power Stone. The Badlands remained just as they were. The night was still alive and well, and the desert surrounding was just as horrid a landscape as when they first arrived. None of that mattered. Thanos raised the Infinity Gauntlet into the air. The winds howled, the dust storm picking up around them, blotting out the night sky. The Black Order shielded their eyes from the storm, but Thanos stared on. He narrowed his stern gaze, clenched his gauntlet, and yelled, "Typhon!" He had felt Typhon's presence the second he stepped on Equus the second time, but now the tremor had only increased, as well as the storm around them. Before it got any worse, before the sand was certain to devour them and never let them escape the desolate wasteland known as the Badlands, the wind stopped. It stopped as the eruption of solid earth followed. Typhon's serpent-like head and demon-like eyes broke through the storms and silenced it. The winds died. The sand fell. Typhon's towering, burning neck and flaming head were all that remained of it. When it all settled and the silence of the night returned, save for Typhon's burning skin, the beast slowly narrowed its eyes on the Mad Titan, slithering closer. Thanos didn't even blink this time as Typhon's burning gaze met his own. Not even the Black Order backed away from the increasing temperatures. Smoke and ash drifted from Typhon's head and nostrils, the beast growling,
"You have returned quickly. I assume with the power needed to resurrect me."
Thanos smiled and slowly turned his left wrist so it faced forward. Typhon shifted his gaze to the gauntlet, widening at the purple gem shimmering next to the bright blue one. Thanos slowly began his approach, stopping just a few yards from Typhon's burning face. He clenched the gauntlet, the Power Stone glowing brightly.
"This may hurt a bit."
Typhon glared at him.
"I've been tortured for more than a millennium. Every shred of my skin melted and peeled away. My intestines, my heart, my lungs, everything within me was ripped away and thrown to the river Styx. My bones were melted to the very chains that held Tartarus together. Every year pulling harder and harder and harder until there was nothing left. Until my very soul was trapped in a forever burning hellscape. Forced to watch as my children suffered the same fate."
Snarling at every syllable, what appeared to be Typhon's maw yielded burning magma that dripped into the dirt and sand. He brought back his neck only slightly, narrowing his slit eyes at the Mad Titan. More specifically, at the Infinity Stone and the power it held. The same power he would experience very shortly. He said,
"I know what it means to hurt. If it hurts,
Then I'll scream.
Thanos could admire that, willing to go through anything to reach his goal. Strange how fate works, bringing two titans together, working together, fighting in the end for similar causes. If he wanted to, Thanos would have smiled, but he didn't. He couldn't when he focused on controlling the Power Stone's energy. The gem shimmered brightly as he clenched the gauntlet harder and harder. But unlike on Xandar, Thanos thrust its energy outwards instead of directly to the ground. A stream of raw, unending energy was propelled from the stone and the Infinity Gauntlet. It was so great, so unhindered, that the Black Order nearly fell back from the shockwave that followed. They shielded themselves as the wave of energy pulsated throughout them. Thanos didn't even move. He kept his left arm jutted outwards, his fist shaking as he forced the gauntlet and the Power Stone's energy directly ahead of him. He watched as it struck its target, right in Typhon's neck. Instantly, the burning red skin encompassing Typhon's neck shifted to a horrible dark purple. Typhon howled in pain, rearing his head straight to the heavens and screaming to the stars. Those screams turned into high-pitched screeches. The Black Order cringed at the sound, some covering their ears. Thanos gritted his teeth, but kept the energy flowing. Unlike when the same power impacted Xandar, this power didn't completely overwhelm Typhon. It nearly had, devouring all of Typhon's neck. It had nearly reached his head, but stopped just at the bottom of his jaw. The purple cracks around his skin yielded, then slowly began to retreat. The purple sickness across Typhon's body quickly fell back to where it originated, where Thanos drove the beam of energy. Typhon's screams soon turned to roars. Then, laughter.
Yes!
Typhon exclaimed, looking down to his neck to see the purple energy withdraw from his skin and flood into his very essence. He reared his head back, roaring,
Yes! The power! I can feel it! My body! My being! There!
A shock wave of energy was all that could be expelled from Typhon's statement, ending his voice there. Thanos cut off the energy flow, shielding his eyes as a wave of energy washed over him and his children, spreading for miles on end, all originating from Typhon. Lowering his naked palm, Thanos stared at the flaming serpent, concern in his frown. Nothing seemed remotely different. Typhon just appeared winded, his head drooping lower and lower to the ground. Speaking of the ground, it had barely survived the shockwave that had occurred not too long ago. Chunks of rock had been expelled from the earth, a small crevice surrounding the Titan. As for Typhon, he breathed steadily. Almost like he had functioning lungs and he was breathing for the first time in more than 1,000 years. Perhaps not far from the truth.
The power.
Typhon breathed in and out, slowly and steadily.
I assume it worked?
Typhon nodded, his glowing red eyes slowly dimming, quickly closing.
Yes. I must rest now. And let the power flow throughout. Let rebuild.
Nodding to that, Thanos lowered his arms so they rested by his sides. His Black Order stepped closer to him, all of their eyes centered on the wilting beast grow smaller and smaller.
I'll take good care of Equus while you're gone, Thanos declared, watching as the mighty tower became less than it was before.
But just before he could fully collapse, Typhon reared forward at speeds that were so unlike him previously, even with his weakening state. The Black Order jutted their weapons outwards, but found no need for them as Thanos stared down the mighty Titan. Neither blinked, neither flinched. Typhon admired that.
Do not forget, Mad Titan. When I return, this world is mine. And the princesses and the pillars are mine to kill.
Thanos said nothing. Didn't even nod. He and his children just watched as the beast disappeared beneath the earth. They felt another tremor pass throughout the Badlands, much stronger than any previous one they had encountered. Amplified with the strength of the Power Stone, there was no wonder Typhon's descent was much stronger than previously. But unlike the previous times, they could see where Typhon traveled next. A wave of red energy shot away from where Thanos and his children stood. They watched as the bolt of red shot across the Badlands beneath the dirt, impacting the tallest peak in the wasteland, the destroyed mountain directly ahead of them. Another tremor passed, not as strong as where they stood, but equally as devastating. The mountain Typhon had struck began to crumble, then began to rise higher out of the ground, practically growing three times before their very eyes. And it just kept getting bigger. Proxima Midnight's jaw fell. Corvus Glaive shared the same fate. Ebony Maw narrowed his gaze and watched as the mountain grew taller and taller, wider and larger. Cull Obsidian watched on in silence. They all looked somewhat concerned, impressed, or surprised. Thanos was not like his children very much. The mountain trembled, then yielded. If it was massive before Typhon had struck it, then it was colossal in size afterwards. No longer was the peak sticking straight out of the ground. It was larger, wider, appearing more like a volcano than a mountain. At least, that's what Thanos and the Black Order thought. Coincidentally enough, a black smog began to bellow from the peak, rising and building just above the mountain. Then all was still and quiet, as if nothing had even happened. "You can't trust him, Father." Thanos slowly turned around, gazing towards Proxima Midnight. She continued, dropping her head a tad. "He threatened to slaughter us the second we stepped foot on this miserable world, and now we just gave him enough power to do whatever it is he just did."
"If he was able to resist the Space Stone beforehand," Corvus Glaive took over, "how powerful will he be now?"
"And when the time of the cleansing is to be upon us, what of Equus, Father?" Ebony Maw asked.
Cull Obsidian grunted and nodded, standing behind his siblings, hammer resting on his shoulder. Thanos turned his eyes to each of their concerned gazes. His expression was unknown, his eyes holding little emotion and revealing nothing. And when he answered, his voice sent shockwaves across each of his children.
"He spared our lives, and we made a bargain. I have fulfilled that bargain. I have given him rebirth. I know I owe nothing more."
"Yes, but at what cost?" Maw asked. "Now this world will be spared."
"Not necessarily."
The Maw actually stepped away from that statement. Just an inch, but it showed. He was clearly taken by surprise at the revelation his father had revealed. Thanos looked to his gauntlet, stared at the two gems still glowing as bright as when he first laid eyes on them.
"The Infinity Stones will take time to acquire, and in the meantime, I will be certain to have this world experience salvation, even if it may be spared from the cleansing."
He heard silence for a moment, then a soft chuckle. Thanos looked to Proxima Midnight, seeing her smile and shake her head.
"Just like old times?" Midnight asked, fingers tightening around her spear. "Half the world's population," Thanos muttered, his voice lost in pure bliss as he gazed at the stones. "Nothing more, nothing less."
Corvus Glaive smiled sickly, each of his fangs showing.
"We will ready the Chitauri right away," he said, bowing his head.
The rest of the Black Order bowed their heads as well, but were shocked to see a blue portal appear behind them. They turned back to their father, seeing him hold out his gauntlet and control the very fabric of space with just the blue gem.
"Leave that to me," Thanos told them. "As for the rest of you, take my ship and retrieve the Reality Stone."
It took a while for Ebony Maw to nod along with the rest of his siblings. The portal's light cascaded their shadows across the dirt, leading to Thanos' feet. He asked,
"What will you do, Father?"
He smiled.
"Make things easier."
And so he would. They didn't need to be told a second time. The Black Order stepped into the portal, one by one. Thanos closed it quickly. As the light died and the stone's light began to dim down, Thanos breathed in the dead air and dust. He stared at where the portal once remained, nothing left but wisps of sand blowing across the wind across the vast desert landscape. The portal wasn't very large, just big enough to fit obsidian. Other than that, Thanos hadn't crafted a portal from the space stone any larger. For what he had in mind, he didn't know if the space stone could have created a portal big enough for him to make things easier, as he had stated not too long ago. Then again, the space stone wouldn't be working alone. He looked to the infinity gauntlet, brought it closer, and stared at the second gem. At the power stone. The very infinity stone that could burn planets in an instant and rebirth ancient titans long since dead for over 1,000 years. Its strength was never-ending, had no limit. The strength of the power stone and the ability of the space stone molded together. He hadn't tried it before. He would now. With his children on their mission to acquire the reality stone, that just left 3. Thanos thought back to where the remaining stones be, all 3 resting in 1 central location. 1 world. Planet Earth. He knew exactly where that was. The years of constantly waiting, constantly watching events unfold on the miserable planet taught him well enough what he should expect. He raised his gauntlet, higher and higher, the face of it turned to the night sky. No need to constantly hop back and forth across the galaxy any longer. Thanos would make things easier. Looking to the stars for guidance, Thanos finally found it. Both the space and power stones igniting brighter than any star that night. Then he closed his left hand. Chapter 9. When Worlds Collide. Low Earth Orbit. ISS Control. In the eyes of Commander Randy Bresnik. Home never looked so gorgeous, Randy thought. In the weightlessness of the black void, Commander Randy Bresnik gently caressed the side of the solar panel, his other hand gripping on one of his repair tools. His eyes, however, were somewhere else. Despite his face hidden behind the black visor of his space helmet, he could tell his team knew he had the biggest damn smile on his face. It was routine maintenance, nothing fantastic. Randy didn't mind taking the reins every now and again. In fact, he loved it, because it gave him an excuse to gaze at home. Planet Earth. God, she never looked so gorgeous. He always said that, but damn it all, she always did. In the corner of his eye, he could see his buddy, Joe Acaba, working on the other side of the ISS, tool in hand, facing away from home, probably doing more work than he was. As Randy turned to Joe, he twisted his body and felt himself turn right. He made sure to grip the edge of the solar panel to stop himself, but then he gazed. Out into the wild black yonder. The glare of the sun was strong, but his visor kept his eyesight safe. As he turned his eyes away from the light, he gazed into the black. Millions upon millions of lights dotted the blackness, crafting a portrait so breathtakingly beautiful he could have wished others back home could have seen it. He always loved stargazing.
ISS Control, this is Houston Command. Do you copy? Over.
Back to work. Randy mentally sighed, pulling himself back towards the solar panel.
Roger, Houston. This is Commander Randy Bresnik reading you loud and clear. Over.
Randy replied, watching as his fellow astronaut, or cosmonaut considering his nationality, and good friend Alexander Misurkin crawled across the ISS, carrying tools. Probably for Joe. Houston replied almost instantly.
ISS Control, we are getting some strange readings near your vicinity. Take a quick sweep towards the eastern side of the Earth. Over. You got this one, Randy?
Paolo Nespoli's voice asked through the comms. Randy kept a strong grip on the solar panel, turning himself over to the right. Yeah, hold on, he replied, his visor facing the far east side of the Earth. Other than seeing the brightness of the sun shimmer against the edge of the hemisphere and the shining lights from the darker areas farther west, there was nothing that appeared strange.
Negative, Houston, Randy replied, still gripping the solar panel and gazing to the world.
No external forces that we can see. Maybe you got some solar flares?
We are unsure at this time, Commander Bresnik. Keep your eyes to home. Over.
You read my mind, Randy thought. He brought himself back to the solar panel and watched his team work below. Both Joe Acaba and Alexander Misurkin were crawling down the solar panel they were working on, both turning themselves backwards to stare at the Earth. Joe pointed forward with his free hand, saying,
"Hey, I got nothing near the Western Hemisphere. Same for the South and North. What say you, Randy?"
Alexander asked, turning his visor up to the astronaut working on the last solar panel. He wasn't working on it. At least, not anymore. Just like the others, he constantly scanned the Earth to find some sort of obstruction, some form of odd occurrence. Yet there was nothing. The comms were silent for almost a minute before Randy finally replied,
ISS Control, there are severe spikes in gravitational instability in your vicinity. Our readings show the ISS is in stable orbit. Is that correct?"
Randy didn't need any confirmation to know that. The ISS had been stable ever since, and there wasn't any form of disturbance and no words of warning from inside to tell him that something was wrong. "Roger, Houston. The ISS is stable. I don't know what to tell you."
"Looking into it, ISS Control. Keep those eyes peeled. We may have a problem here."
The grave tone Houston Command gave didn't calm Randy's growing anxiety about the current situation. That anxiety was starting to grow the longer he tried to reach for the disturbance Houston may have found. Yet there was still nothing that he could see. That anxiety started to send shockwaves across his skin beneath his suit, causing a very unnatural chill to race up and down his spine.
"You feeling that?"
Joe asked, gazing at his palm and arm. Alex turned to him, nodding. Or tried to. He moved backwards and forwards, but still said,
"I thought I was the only one. What do you see out there, Commander?"
Mark Van de Hei said from within the ISS. "Nothing." Randy saw absolutely nothing. Could have been a solar flare, but they would have been informed earlier if that was so. Feeling the need to tell Houston something of interest, Randy kept his eyes on Earth, saying into his comms, "Houston Command, about those strange readings you mentioned earlier. We're starting to..." Then he felt it. It felt like a tug at first. Then it tried to pry him right off the solar panel. Randy reared forward, abandoning his tools and holding onto the solar panel for dear life. He saw below as Alex and Joe were almost pulled back themselves, but they found a grip somewhere against the hull on the ISS. Finding a steady grip himself with one arm, Randy turned himself backwards, trying to catch what caused the strong gravitational pull that he felt. He saw it. He almost couldn't believe it.
"What the hell?"
They all saw it. It was almost unreal, but it was there just as clearly as Randy saw the world and the stars in the void. It was almost like a tear in the sky. That was the best he could put it. Then it grew, holding a bright blue aura around its edges and forming a massive orb. It grew so gargantuan that Randy couldn't even see where it began and where it ended any longer. Within the orb it created, something emerged, almost like it was pushed or pulled forward. Out of the darkness came something that made Randy's heart plummet.
"ISS Control, what's going on down there?"
Houston Command screamed, the comms fizzling out. Static was their response, but they managed to catch Mark Van Hei scream,
"Oh my god! Oh my god!"
Communications to Houston were instantly cut when the massive object came fully into view. "Houston?" Randy asked, voice heavy and breathless. The front of his helmet quickly began to fog up from his continued breath.
"Houston!"
he screamed, spittle hitting his mask.
"Randy, get back inside!"
Cosmonaut Sergei Ryansensky shouted on their shared comms unit. He felt the panel lurch forward towards the massive object escaping the vortex, now clearly the source of the gravitational pull he and his team felt earlier. Randy reached back and gripped onto it with all the strength he could muster, gasping for air almost like he couldn't breathe.
"ISS has broken orbit!"
Paolo Nespoli screamed.
"We're being sucked into the planet!"
The planet.
"Randy, get out of there!"
Joe exclaimed, waving up to his fellow astronaut from below, where he and Alex barely held on. The planet. Not Earth. Commander Bresnik didn't answer. As he gripped onto the solar panel, his eyes were forced away from the approaching celestial body and turned towards the far western hemisphere, beyond Earth. He reached up to his helmet, slowly but surely raising his visor with a shaking glove. His expression said it all. Complete and utter shock, suddenly filled with unhinged terror. His eyes continued to grow.
Randy!
Another Terran space appeared, this one far from Earth, but near something else. Randy could only watch as a second celestial body was practically pulled out of the shimmering black and blue vortex. It slowly moved forward, onward, closer and closer, like time itself slowed down. He couldn't even breathe when that celestial body impacted the moon. His body was on fire. All of his communications were fried. As he watched the ISS get torn apart and free fall to the planet above them, the last thing he saw were chunks of the moon scatter from their collision, each piece moving towards Earth very, very slowly. And then he closed his eyes and burned as he and his crew fell to the new world. Chapter 10. Celestial Fire. Earth. Florida, USA, Clearwater Beach, 11:48 p.m. Jack Spencer was never lucky with the ladies. The pulsating beats from the massive stereo systems could be felt for miles across the long, sandy beaches. It was so incredibly loud that the very sand danced alongside the twirling, half-naked bodies of the partiers. Colorful lights shot off from the massive stage and bounced up and down, following both the beat of the song and hundreds of people dancing to it. Summer nights and parties. Late summer nights and parties. The entire beach had transformed into a rave once the sun fell, and had been going non-stop. Aside from the mountains of trash stacked in massive piles and scattered across the edges of the area the rave was occurring, and completely ignoring the couples making out on tangled blankets from one end of the beach to the other, Jack Spencer found the experience to be relatively enjoyable. Sure, he got a few drinks splashed in his face whenever he got too close to the nearest chick in the smallest bikini, but when didn't that happen every now again? Jack liked to believe that, anyway, as he stumbled towards the shore to take a piss. He slurred the wrong words to the wrong song he wanted to think of as he undid his belt buckle, zipped his fly down, and let nature take its course. Jack wasn't particularly kept together, considering he was on his fifth Jack Daniels and counting. He always liked to drink something named after him. He was an ass that way. But when he decided it was time to drain the tank, he thought of no better place than the wide ocean, the same place where all little sea critters did their business. It only made sense to follow the natural order of things, right? Well, he tried to, at least. The shore seemed to shrink away from his piss trail. Confused, Jack whistled a tune and stumbled slowly forward, looking like a bow-legged jackass. A couple broke their lips away from each other and saw him, trying to hide their laughter. They never saw the shore shrink back into the sea. No one did. No one except Jack.
Hey!
Jack burped, continuing to push himself onward, trying to catch the water with his draining urine, which had miraculously managed to continue in a stream lasting longer than 20 seconds.
Where do you think you're going, Buster? You're not going anywhere until I add your density or whatever science shit.
Jack let loose whatever else he had when the sirens started crying. The sounds of the rave were instantly drowned out by the sounds of concerned partiers, everyone yelling at the DJ to turn up the music. They used more colorful language. The DJ flipped everyone off and pointed towards the ocean, all eyes turning in said direction. By the time everyone did, the tsunami sirens were drowned out by the screams. Human screams. Terrified, shocked, confused, all directed towards the approaching tide and retreating quickly from it. But not Jack Spencer. Even as the entire beach line was abandoned and everyone ran for their lives, only Jack Spencer was the one to notice the massive planet covering half of the night sky. Then the wave washed him and half of the city away. Equus, Manhattan, Equestria, 9:55 p.m. Coco Pomel was awakened to the sounds of the city. She groaned, pulling the side of her pillow over to cover her face, and hopefully block out the constant noise. It was no use, as even the slightest, smallest noise managed to slip through her pillow and keep her awake. Aggravated, the pony kicked away her covers and strode towards the window. It had been a long, busy day for Miss Pommel. What went as an average planning schedule for the Midsummer Theater revival turned to absolute disaster when her actors canceled on her, saying they would be spending the summer traveling to Saudi Arabia to be performing in another play. That information alone set Coco back even further on her planning for the play. She would have to hire new actors, still set up an appointment for renting the location, set up the stage, and get the costumes ready. If things didn't get going more smoothly by tomorrow, she would have to push the Midsummer Theater to the end of the summer. It was tiresome. It was painful. Coco sighed as she approached her apartment's window. If only she had Applejack and Rarity to help her this time around. That option was always on the table. But for now, she just wanted to get a good rest before starting the same routine the next morning. Those sounds that just so happened to arise almost near midnight kept her up. At least, that's what her clock read. Pushing her curtains that stood directly behind her desk aside, she expected to see the usual traffic jam. Ponies screaming at each other, everything that ever was Manhattan, and nothing else. That's not what she saw. Instead, the light of the moon that used to shine directly into her apartment was no more. It was dimmer, surely not as bright as it once was. It was not as it once was, appearing to have been shattered, broken against another moon that was nearly identical to it. Her eyes widened at that. But her jaw fell when she saw the other world hanging directly over her city. She could see the lights, presumably from the cities that could have existed on the alien world. It was so dangerously close that Coco Pommel instinctively took a step back, but not before casting a quick glance to the city below. Ponies screamed and fled the streets, some gazing up to the planet and sharing the same expression Coco felt. She found slight comfort in that, knowing now she wasn't seeing things. Her attention shifted to something else, something that literally arose from her desk. Her quill and parchment began to float, hovering just a few feet above her wooden desk. Coco froze at that, her breathing intensifying. Mustering up enough bravery, she rose her shivering hoof and poked at the quill. It spun from her touch, but continued to hover in place. By the time Coco brought her hoof back, she was already off the ground, hovering several feet from her floor. Her screams joined the thousands of other ponies who began to rise from the earth. Earth. New York, USA. Manhattan. Curtis Hoyle's rehab session. 11:59 p.m. Frank Castle's watch beeped twice, causing the drowsy veteran to stir in his chair. He stared at his watch, noticing that the time read midnight. He growled, but decided it was as time as ever to head home. "I was wondering when you were gonna get up." Frank looked back, noticing Curtis stacking the remaining chairs away. Sighing, Frank got up, practically dragging his chair, the metal legs scratching against the floor. It was not Frank's first time during Curtis's rehab sessions for recovering veterans. But week after week, things only seemed to be getting more stale. Nothing seemed to change. Other veterans, people, always told Curtis that he was doing something right, that they had something to look forward to. For Frank, he just felt like he already told his story to them, and he was just there for Curtis. Not a bad thing, just something he felt obligated to go to instead of willing. Pulling the chair forward, Frank handed it to his old friend, who smiled and received it. "Hey, Kurt, sorry about drowsing off during your, Frank began to say, but was instantly cut off. "It's not the first time it's happened, Frank. No biggie," Curtis said, placing the last chair with the others. Curtis walked past Frank, who only nodded and followed several feet behind him. "You should have woke me up earlier," Castle called to him, who only chuckled to that. "I was planning on it, but you just look so peaceful," Curtis laughed, placing the remaining cookies into a Ziploc bag. There wasn't much coffee left, so he just placed the dirty mugs into his backpack and left the coffee maker. He shoved the cookies into his backpack, zipped it up, and whipped it to his backside. He met Frank's humored look, his smile growing wider. Frank actually laughed.
"Must be thinking of someone else,"
Both men chuckled at that, turning towards the exit and making their approach. When Frank came to his side, Curtis dropped his gaze. He said, "I wasn't intending to make the meeting last so long. So sorry about that."
"Hey, don't worry about it," Frank said, slapping his shoulder. "Time gets away from you."
"You ready to head out? You already locked up the place?" "Just about to do that. Go on, I'll meet you outside," Curtis said to Frank, who nodded and zipped up his jacket, heading for the building's exit. Curtis reached into his coat pocket, fumbled with the keys, and turned off the lights to the room. He closed the door and locked both. Checking them just for safety reasons, neither budged, and Curtis held onto his keys as he approached the exit. As he did, something came quickly, causing Curtis to furrow his brow. It sounded quiet at first, but quickly rose the closer he got to the exit. It sounded like the blaring of car horns, which was normal, but then it transformed into something horrific, something a veteran like Curtis Hoyle hated hearing. Screams. He ran out the door, seeing Frank gazing up into the night sky. "Hey, Frank, what's all that?" Curtis couldn't even finish that thought. He stopped dead next to Castle, eyes in complete and utter disbelief at what he saw. Resting on the horizon, appearing so large that the very skyscrapers of New York City appeared like blades of grass to it, an alien planet hovered dangerously close. Too close. The sounds of terror erupted further into the city, news choppers quickly filling the night sky and approaching the horizon. As for Frank Castle and Curtis Hoyle, they just stood there. Curtis turned to his left, noticing absolutely no change in Frank's expression or appearance. He held that same scowl he had most of his waking life, and he glared at the planet that filled a strong portion of the night sky. "Frank?" Curtis gasped. Frank turned his way, noticing the worry and confusion grip Curtis's features. He only sighed, turning back towards the alien world. "Ah, shit."
Equus, Mount Eris, Hippogriffia, 10:03 p.m. The horns sounded off slightly past midnight. At least, that's what all the clocks in Hippogriffia read. After that, the city of Hippogriffia awakened from the night. Hippogriffs big and small, young and old, royalty and commoners, arose from their rebuilt homes and stumbled through the reconstruction efforts of their city. They passed the gates, stood on the edge of their mountain, and stared at the alien planet directly over their heads. It covered nearly all of the night sky, small lights blinking upon its continents. The moon's light was even brighter and larger than before, considering a second moon had impacted Luna's own. Chunks of the two moons slowly drifted closer and closer to both worlds. Not only that, but large waves crashed against their mountain, nearly reaching the summit, but stopping just close enough for the mist of the sea to reach near the city's entrance. The hippogriffs turned to one another, whispering words of worry, some of the young ones crying. Queen Novo and her daughter, Princess Skystar, the highest authority amongst their people, approached the edge of the mountain, several hippogriffs backing away to let them through. Queen Novo, clear-minded and calculated, glared at the alien planet hanging so dangerously close to their own. She glared at the irregularly massive waves impacting her mountain. She glared at the fact that the homes that laid at the base of the mountain were gone, consumed by the ocean. Princess Skystar, more free-spirited and bubbly, gasped loudly, gripping the edge of the cliff with her claws. Her eyes grew 10 times as wide, an excited scream escaped in the young princess.
"Oh my goodness!"
Skystar cried, the tips of her wings flapping up and down, causing her to rise slightly on the tip of her claws and hooves. She clutched onto her mother's neck, who hardly looked amused by her behavior.
"Mom, look, a new world! You know what that means? New people! Can we offer a warm welcome, huh? Can we? Can we? Can we?"
She pressed firmly on De Novo's side with her claws. The queen just shook her head, bending her head down to the nearest guard to her right. "Send a letter to Princess Celestia right away. Inform her of this anomaly," she whispered. The guard saluted, spread his wings, and took off back for the castle deeper within the mountain.
General Seaspray and the remaining guards stood by their queen, gazing onto the world above. Skybeak stood by his children, Silverstream and Terramar. They rubbed the sleepiness from their eyes, standing by their cousin Skystar's side. Their beaks fell in awe. Skystar, on the other hand, hopped up and down in clear excitement, not a hint of weariness in her form. Sea ponies rose from the ocean waves, shocked to see the peak of Mount Eris at such a close proximity. They were even more shocked, however, to see the alien world above their heads and glinting on the ocean surface. Ocean Flow swam towards her husband Skybeak and her children, hugging them, turning in fear to the world above their heads. With that, Queen Novo and her subjects stood in continued silence as the new world sat quietly above them, like a sleeping giant. Hippogriffs questioned their queen, but she could offer no answer. No true explanation. Princess Skystar clapped her claws together, grinning as wide as her beak could manage.
I got a really good feeling about this one.
Earth. Edinburgh, Scotland. 5:09 a.m. It was everywhere. On the early morning news stations, on every station throughout the country, and even the entire world. Everyone either heard of it or saw it with their own eyes. Those who hadn't would soon, because that morning, the entire world would change forever. The Vision knew this and turned off the television. He stared for a moment at his pale, tannish palm, looking over his hand with a certain dullness. A soft mumble from behind caught his attention, and he turned around to the bed where she lay. He stood up, slowly making his way over to the mattress and tangled sheets. Lying there, alone, with her dark hair just as a tangled mess, was the most beautiful sight he ever laid his eyes on. There she lay, Wanda Maximoff, her clothing discarded and only the sheet covering her nakedness. Okay. She lay with a soft smile, dreaming of elsewhere, anything other than the madness of the real world. The Vision gently caressed her forehead, earning a sigh and a soft smile from her. And then he turned. He pushed the drapes away, staring out into the cloudy morning sky. And above, through the clouds, as clear as could be, was the planet. It was alien, surely, as was the moon that impacted Earth's own natural satellite. Heavy chunks of space rock were drifting away from the impact zone. Slowly, so very slowly. There was nothing of interest found in the destruction of the two moons. So Vision looked toward the alien world. The soft morning light made it difficult, but he could certainly notice several lights illuminating from the surface of the planet, indicating some form of possible life. It was a stretch, but it's what he could formulate at the moment. There appeared to be several white splotches scattered across the surface, possibly being clouds, indicating an atmosphere, one with moisture, water, which most certainly pointed to life. Alien life. Already the circumstances and fallout from this event that morning played through Vision's growing mind. After the last alien attack, humanity would most certainly discover that there was life on the alien world, and was spawned with ill intentions. They would either be confused, scared, or angry. That didn't even count how much destruction the new world would cause to Earth just from its gravitational pull. An Earth to the new world. Why or how it appeared near Earth was still a mystery he would need to solve. But at that moment, at that very moment, he saw something. It was a flicker, but one that caught his interests. He swore he saw two other lights from the planet's surface, one purple and one blue. He flinched as his forehead, as the Mind Stone, began to pulsate. Equus, Canterlot Equestria, Celestia's Quarters, 10:12 p.m. Celestia stepped onto her balcony after hearing the cries from Canterlot below. She ignored the cool summer wind and the cries that came with it. She focused on the more important cries, the ones from her subjects, her little ponies. She didn't even need to look to Canterlot to know what had disturbed them. More than half of the night sky was gone, replaced by a dark orb with shimmering lights upon its surface. At first, Celestia thought it was a ship, but then noticed its distance, where it lied, its shape, and what it appeared to be. It was a planet, a new world, one that somehow appeared, just appeared. Celestia gripped the edge of her balcony, the screams from the ponies below creating a symphony of terror the longer she stared at the new world and the remains of her sister's moon. Luna's moon remained nothing but a smoldering cluster of space rock, slowly drifting away from the second moon it impacted. They shone a ghostly pale white, resting, drifting, moving closer and closer toward her world and the new one. Celestia gasped, her jaw falling but no other breaths escaping her. A pair of hooves impacting marble brought Celestia out of her petrified state. It was followed shortly by a painful cry that tried to remain concealed, but was unable to do so. Celestia turned around, gazing and nearly breaking down herself to see the tear-stained face of Princess Luna, her little sister, nearly broken. Her eyes were bloodshot, chest heaving in and out as tears streaked down her cheeks. She wore a frown, a furious one. One that held unbridled rage and boiling intensity she had never seen. But it was held together, somehow held together by whatever strength and determination that Luna had crafted over the years since her return. But still, Celestia hadn't seen her cry so terribly since the rise of Nightmare Moon.
"Sister,"
Luna breathed, her voice shaking, all with pain, fury, and confusion.
"Get Discord, and stop the moons from getting any closer," Celestia ordered. She didn't even hesitate. "But
now!" Luna flinched back. Her expression of confusion was replaced instantly with one of forced strength and rising determination. She nodded, disappearing in a flash. The cries came back, even more horrible than before. Somehow, Celestia couldn't just hear the cries from Canterlot. She heard the ones from Ponyville, from Manhattan, from Philadelphia, from everywhere. They all combined into a mixture of pain, horror, confusion, and so much more. So many terrible things that Celestia had to close her eyes and clench her jaw just to be able to face it all. The longer she did so, the longer she tried to block out the cries, the more powerful they came. Like a blistering fire that couldn't be stopped. Celestia opened her eyes. Canterlot was beginning to awaken from the commotion. The second world and the second moon remained where they were, and she didn't know why.
"What does this mean?"
she asked no one. No one replied. As she stared at the new world dangerously close to her own, the wind picked up, screaming past her ears. It sounded like seven screams, the kind she knew, and Celestia shivered. She shivered, despite the blazing fire ringing in her ears.